Good afternoon and welcome to Resin Sacket. It's Wednesday night and we're live! Call that the wrong way around then! Actually forgot to unmute you guys as well, so whatever sound
I didn't
just said,
anyway.
No one heard.
Anyway. God, I've missed you!
Yes, I've missed everybody. Welcome to the show, everyone. It is Wednesday night and we are live. We are Resonance Arcade. We are four blokes from the northwest, northeast, north of England. I'll get that right one day. And we talk about games for a couple of hours every Wednesday night. We weren't around last week because essentially I decided that I wanted to play The Witcher 3. That is why. Lou sent me a text and he said, "Oh, I might not be able to get back because I'm having sex with my girlfriend." And then when he didn't arrive, I thought, "Oh, bugger it. I'll send the guys a text and say, I want to play Witcher 3. And I did actually do that. I was very transparent about it. And,
so you decided to have sex with some whores in a brothel?
No, I didn't. I've only just found the brothel, the first brothel in the game. that is my game of the moment anyway, Witcher 3. I'm absolutely enamoured with it. And I know you're not, Lou.
Shall we start here then?
Well, let's start here.
Since Chris and I already kind of sung the game's praises a bit, why don't we get the dissenting opinion first and then Chris and I can just tell you how wrong he is?
Right, well, I haven't played the game enough to actually make comment on the game itself. My problem is the bloody control system.
Don't wait for me to respond. I'm not going to respond to that shit.
Right, games increasingly have been really poorly designed in terms of the controls. So, you buy a PC game and you expect to be able to change the controls to whatever you need them to be. That's why you have a section where you can configure your controls, but it doesn't let you do certain things. Like, here's a small bugbear, but it's a really annoying one if you're stuck on the cursor island like me. By default, the X key is bound to stop your horse and call your horse. Yeah? Two handy functions to have on one key that you can't do at the same time. If you want that on any other key, you can't have the same key for both of those things.
Because of the way it binds.
Yeah, it forces you to unbind the other control.
Oh, okay.
Yet by default, it's set up with two controls on one key.
Is it not a config file?
Maybe,
didn't
I don't know
look,
what
did
engine.
You?
I didn't look, no. But that's one of the many things. Basically, it's forcing me to play it with a pad because I don't have enough keys to play this game where I play on left-handed on the cursor island.
Go on.
So literally, I can't play it. I can't play it because I'd have to play it on a pad, and if I'm playing on a pad, I might as well have it on a console. And I bought it for the PC. I own a PC. I play games on a PC for a very good reason, because I like playing games on a PC, and I don't like using a pad.
Still going, yeah.
So I'm really, really annoyed at it, because I want to play it. I'm sure it is a very good game. It has a kind of cool Skyrim-y feel to it, but I can't. Because of the controls. And this is happening all the time. This is not just The Witcher.
I've just found Witcher 3. We're PC gamers and we demand compatibility and we demand all of this configurability and everything else, yeah? And we also demand being able to mod games and all the other stuff that PC gamers demand. I've just found, very quick Google search, a binding fixer that allows you to bind. In fact, the first one in the function list is rebinds any key currently bound in the game to another. So you can bind duplicate keys to different keys. So that's
why isn't that in the game by default? Or why? No, I know what you mean, that we like to configure our games, yeah? But I don't like to have to download a separate tool to allow me to configure the game. Because that stuff should be in. Has anyone even tested this game left-handed? Tested it on a keyboard and mouse?
There's only about two left-handed people in the world, though, Lou. That's the problem.
They're actually a fair proportion of the world is left-handed. It annoys me. Why give you the option to configure the keys if you can't even configure the keys properly? And it's not like this is something hard to do. Games have been doing this for 20, 30 years.
You know what? I used to have the same bugbear, and when I was on my ridiculous strafe left and right with the mouse button thing, I used to have the same problem because a lot of the time, because you have to double, especially modern games, mainly scale form stuff, you double click on something and then you couldn't left or right click. Right click would cancel it and left click would I don't know, change it back to what it was or something like that. You know, I've had that a few times in games. Skyrim was one of them. I couldn't do it. I couldn't bind my strafe to left and right. But I changed my key config because I was working with Unity all the time, and I went to WASD for moving, and I've got so used to it now that I use that all the time. Now, these days, I don't even change key bindings anymore. I don't even change what use and open and everything. You know, like GTA 5, the F is the main use key. It's getting in and out cars. E is usually the key that I use for using things. But,
well, I use enter, but a lot of games don't let you bind enter anymore. A lot of games don't let you bind backspace now as well, and that's another one of my go-to keys. If you look at your keyboard, all the keys around the cursors are what I have to use.
You don't think it's accessibility? Because the accessibility thing is they've got to have a way to navigate menus by default for everybody.
That's menus. I mean, when you're in the game, you're not in a menu.
No,
I wouldn't mind.
But you'll still need to, it might, depending on what the menus are and where they are in the game, sometimes you've got interactive menus inside the game, or you've got in-game, you know, 3D menus in the actual game itself. Anyway, I've know your frustration. I'm not having a go, but you're not giving it any time because of this. And it's a wonderful game, and I mean truly wonderful from start to the end.
Sell it to me, the both of you, because I'm really frustrated with it, and it's just a long line of games that have done this to me, and it's getting increasingly bad.
And Skyrim was hard to bind keys. It was not
as hard
as UI.
Not as hard as this.
Skyrim had an utterly broken UI. I had to mod it heavily for it to even work remotely correctly. And in fact, because I used to strafe with my left and right keys, and I did try that in Skyrim, I couldn't do it in the UI itself on the first one or two releases or whatever, so I did it in the config, and I bound them, and then every time I tried to click in my inventory, it would change the inventory thing and sometimes randomly open up things and use items, and I'm like,
yeah.
But I got over it. You know, I got over that and figured out how to work with it.
It's also the sheer amount of controls as well, like having two separate buttons for soft and hard attack. I don't know why you could just hold down
You don't have that in Witcher.
Yeah, you do.
You do? You've got a light attack and a hard attack.
Yeah, you got light attack, heavy attack.
Sorry, yeah, you hold down shift and click. Hold down shift
not
and click.
Not me. I can't do that.
Hold down control and click.
I've got to shift down to something else.
So hang on, is it on the PC controls? You have to hold down shift and then do it. Yeah, but on the controller, it's two separate buttons.
So
two different buttons.
Yeah, square and triangle on my controller. Square is fast, triangle is heavy. That's like a really standard like fighting thing that's really common in third-person fighting games.
But
really
it's
common.
Basically, light attack is left click. But I haven't rebound any of the controls. Light attack is left click, and hold shift and left click, and that's your heavy attack. It works really well for WASD. I like it. I like the fact that I can switch between them dead quick. Right. I'm going to sell it to you in a few different ways. There's only one or two bugbears that I've got with the game. And I've read a few other people who've had bugbears, but a lot of these people are very critical of every game. You know, the critics at the end of the day, and that's what they do. They spend the time picking out the bugs and the issues. I've loved every second that I've spent in this, and I've spent a lot of 2 a.m., 4 a.m. sessions hammering it to death. I'm only somewhat like level 13 or something now, but I'm doing pretty well. You know, I've got a lot of the side quests done, and I'm going through it. It doesn't feel like a grind in it. That's one of my things. You know, RPGs are typically that you go and do fetch quests, you go and do various other quests. It's all filler, but none of it really feels like filler to me. It feels like I'm actually engaging with each of the characters. Each one has got its own little story. Each one has got its own little... I mean, of course, there are a few that are just go up to a monster's nest and blow it up. You know, that's just a standard thing. But generally, I've found that all of the contract missions where you'd go and you'd go to a notice board, pick a monster contract up, go and find the person to... It's kind of the same thing most of the time, but each one has got their own little story and each one's got their own characters and their own kind of interest, if you know what I mean. And each one is slightly different as well.
There's so, that sort of like detective work with them as well.
Yeah, the detective work is a nice element to it, but that is quite samey. That's probably one of my criticisms, because you basically, you find some monster tracks or some blood, and then you follow them with your Witcher sensors, which is holding right click down. That's all you do in this. And then once you've found the spot, so depending on what type of monster you have to fight, if it's a Noon Wraith or something, you might have to burn someone's items or the Noon Wraith's original items, and they'll... There's lots of lore around each monster as well. Like Noon Wraiths, for example, are brides that have died just before they're going to get married or something like that, and then there's only a few of them in the game. But
have you encountered the botchling yet? Like a botchling, yes, is basically like a sort of a miscarried child that sort of turns into a demon. It's
very dark,
and you can either choose to kill it, and kill it that way, or you can do like a ritual that sort of cleanses it and lets the botchling be free, and then it also serves as a protector for the house as well. So I quite like that sort of stuff.
Yeah, that there's lots of things. Everything's got a reason in the game. Every monster has got its own little story. Every character has got its own little kind of... It feels like it's a real world, even though there's a lot of repetitive quests in there. Still, it's like any other RPG. It's like any kind of Assassin's Creed or anything, you know, where you've got all this filler stuff, but it just feels like it's more than just go to a point, pick a quest up, and then do it. That's the only way I can describe the side quests. They actually feel like I want to do them. I don't feel like I'm grinding for experience. Every quest has got kind of a level suggestion as well. You can go and do some that are insane levels if you want, but you're not going to get very far on them, like most RPGs.
That's interesting. So it's not like Skyrim in that the whole game revolves around your level.
No, not at all. No, no. You could. I've quite often run into a griffin or something that's been. Sometimes it's just got question marks and it's way above my level, and literally one hit and I'm utterly knackered.
I walked into an
area of the game down south in Velen. Is it Velen's the second place, isn't it? Down south in Velen, kind of the southwest area. It's just full of high-level monsters.
That whole area is brutal.
I mean, I've been running through it, and it's fine. You can run away from any monster. You know, you're not going to get knackered just by walking in an area, but you can't fight some of the monsters. And sometimes, like, each monster, again, has its own attack patterns, although there are a few that seem to have the similar kind, like Griffin and the cockatrice, or whatever they are.
Yeah. Pretty much the same.
Yeah, pretty much exactly the same. But the cockatrice, all that is, I found out if you read the bestiary, all that is just a named griffin. That's all it is. So I didn't realise that until I re-looked at it. But every monster has its own thing, and there's also a number of different ways to kill each monster. You can either... Well, you can use all ways if you want. You've got your magic, which I find the magic really, really, really interesting. I love the different types you can get. You basically have access to everything at the start. I think there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 or 6 signs. Is the loot?
There's the magic. There's the purple one, which is like a magic.
You've got Axie, Igni, Igni, Yerdan,
Ard.
Ard is like a force push. Axie's a mind control thing, which stuns enemies or does various different things. You can also got upgrade trees on each of them, but you get access to all of them from the start, and it uses your adrenaline to it feels natural anyway. You can quite easily be sword playing. You can be attacking people with swords, jumping around and dodging and stuff, and using your magic, and also applying oils to your sword, and also using potions. All at the same time, and you can combine them all, and it doesn't feel like you're restricted like you may do if you decide to spec a mage, for example, in another thing. You can leave your Igni, which is a fire spell. You can leave that at like level 1, never upgrade it, and it's still useful for certain enemies. It's better for some than it is for others. But I just feel like I want to play it all the time. I feel like I want to. I haven't had a since Skyrim, I think I would say. I haven't played a game that's made me just dragged me in so much, you know.
And I have to say, as much as the world is really engrossing, I find that the little bits of the story that I'm getting, I'm really enjoying them. Like you say, every single little piece of the game's got its own story to it. Things don't feel like they're just procedurally generated stuff in the world. It feels like the world is constructed, but also natural. It's not like really artificially constructed. Like you can tell, it's just blocks or whatever.
I haven't felt like any of the quests have been randomly generated. Is there actually a random generator?
No. What I'm saying is they're not. What's the word I'm looking for? Like in Oblivion, for example, there was a lot of sort of stock caves, weren't there? Mm. But you go into a cave and it'd be cave layout number 3, sort of thing.
Yeah.
This feels like each area and quest that you do has got its own layout and its own sort of handcrafted thing going on, its own little narrative or its own little adventure that you have to go on for every single little thing that you do. I really enjoy that and appreciate it.
Yeah,
their sort of story is... I get the feeling that the story is quite long and I'm about where you are, Chris. I'm level 12.
Have you gone to Novigrad yet?
No, it's on my map, but I just haven't been there yet. I've got too many side quests to do in Velen yet. I know that it's right next to Velen.
Well, all natural. It just kind of, everything flows into it. I walked into Novigrad without knowing I was there because I was doing a quest around near it. And I was like, I walked into it. I actually spent 2 days walking around the city just speaking to people and going to merchants and trying to find out where everything was and selling items and stuff. It's lovely. It's lovely. It's a pleasurable experience from start to end. Apart from maybe the controls for you, Lou, I haven't played an RPG that's felt as natural as this for years.
There's a couple of glitches in the game. I've noticed just today. I was crossing a certain bridge, and I went over it because of a separate issue that also is a bugbear of mine. I got off my horse and gone over the bridge, killed a couple of bandits, and then called Roach over. And he started walking over the bridge and just glitched underneath it. So right. I was like, right. So I ran up a couple of hundred yards up the road. And this is the thing that the game does. You can call your horse to you, like in Red Dead Redemption. So if you run away, your horse will just sort of spawn near you in a way. So you can kind of, if that happens, you can run away and then spawn him. Like if you go to a weird little island where you left your horse on the shore, then whistle him, he's there. And you're like, okay.
Yeah, I literally, every time I go to the sea and I'm like, right, I can't be asked finding a bridge. I'm just going to get off Roach, swim across the ocean, kill a few drowners that are in the water in the meantime, get across there, and then as soon as I get to the other side, just call Roach and he's there. He's right on me. Yeah. There's also one other issue with that kind of thing, and that's the kind of the urgency and agent and urgency issue that's with it, in that at the very beginning of the game, you basically told you have to come by what's her name? What's the sorceress called? The black-eyed sorceress girl?
Yennefer.
By Yennefer, it's like, come and meet me quickly. I haven't bothered. And I've been playing it for 40 odd hours now. Just haven't bothered. And there's a lot of that.
You must have gone to Yennefer if you've got to Velen.
Yeah, but there's more after that. Then she says, right, I'll meet you in the next
place.
Oh, right,
yeah.
And that's what I mean. There's all this, right, come quick. In fact, she actually says at one point, come quickly and don't dally about. I don't know if I hope I get told off for dallying about when I get there, because I'll be quite disappointed if I don't. But I don't know if that's going to happen or not.
I don't know, that's like a really common thing in open world games where like, we must do this mission, and you're like, yeah, but I'm going to go and just like kill some random animals.
Yeah, it's
for about 3 hours.
Problem. It happens everywhere, but yeah.
There's one more little thing with Roach as well. It's just that the horse randomly stops, or like when you're going into townships or city areas, you'll be walking down a road. And this has happened to me in a couple of horse races where it was infuriating.
Yeah,
you're galloping and the horse just goes, and stops. And you're like, why have you stopped? And then you have to get him to go again. And you're like, there's no reason for the horse to stop there. It does that a few times. Like, it's quite a few bits on the map where the horse will just go, I don't like it, and stops.
I've had that.
But it shouldn't.
I've had that, but only when I've run into something. I haven't had that in invisible walls or anything like that so far. But it is very annoying because the collision boundaries are ridiculous. It's like, you know, there's a tiny little rock like that and you'll get stuck on it. That's annoying to me.
I will say one thing. They have managed to convey the idea that the horse is alive, and that you're sort of guiding it when it runs, but if it wants to go a certain way around a tree, it's going to go that way around the tree. You have to just live with it, which is what I'd imagine a real horse would do if you're galloping through the woods like an idiot, which you probably shouldn't do, is gallop through the woods.
Yeah, the fact that you can upgrade your horse as well, that sounds a bit daft to someone who probably hasn't played it as much as Lou, but you basically upgrade your horse with blinkers. Whenever you run near enemies, you get a fear level, and the fear level of your horse rides up. And if the horse gets too frightened, it'll kick you off, and you'll be stunned for a little bit.
I remember the first battle I had, the horse was kicking the shit out of some goblins. or something.
The horse will sort of rear a buck, but the horse doesn't take any damage, so yeah. I don't think it yeah. deals any damage either, from what I've seen.
It looked like it was having a fight with some of the enemies.
You can, if you walk behind someone else's horse, you can get kicked in the face by it. Because if the other person's horse is like, say you've knocked a bandit off their horse and the horse stops, if you walk behind it, you can get booted. and that's quite funny.
If you attack enemies from horseback before the horse fear goes up, the damage is pretty goddamn good, but the timing of it is very difficult.
Yeah.
So if you try and run at an enemy and just try and do a running slash, if you hit it, it's really powerful, but it's hard to get right. So most of the time, if I do a couple of passes sometimes on my horse,
yeah,
to try and have a slash, and then I'll just jump off and kill him.
Yeah, I'm the same. I have done a few higher level fights. If there's like loads and loads of bandits. In fact, there was one place. There was a whole beach full of pirates, like bandits, and it was because it was a really long, like open area. I decided to do it all on horseback because there was about 20 of them. I tried doing it without. First, and they were just shooting me with arrows from a distance. So every time I dodged, I got shot with an arrow, and every time I tried to hit someone, I got shot with an arrow because there's like six people over there shooting me, and then there's the six people you have to deal with around you, and then there's more people that keep appearing. So I just thought, bugger this, gonna do it on my horse, and I killed them. I killed all but about maybe four of them, then jumped off and finished the four off with me skills.
Yeah, it's difficult to say things about it that we haven't already kind of said. It's just more. The things that I said about it last time we spoke are all the things that I like now. I'm just liking them more because I spent more time with them. I really like the combat even more than I did before because I've got to grips with how the blocking and parrying and the dodging really works now and judging what attacks you need to dodge and which ones you can take. And it also depends on what level you are. I think the higher level you are, like an enemy will have like a hard attack that if you were at a lower level, you would hit it and you get your guard would be like broken. Whereas when you're at a high level, you just go dink, no worries, and chop their head off. So I like that as well, that your whole fighting prowess gets more powerful as you become a higher level, which I quite like about the leveling system in general, that you can encounter an enemy. I like that the enemies don't scale to you. The enemies are as powerful as they are, and it's up to you to get to that level to match them.
But saying that, there's still the case where if you get surrounded by a pack, I mean, I'm level 12, 13, as I said, but if I get surrounded by like 8 or 9 wolves... Some even and wolves are like level 3. I could still easily get knacked by them if I don't dodge and attack them and fight them properly. That's what I really like about it because there's the gang mentality. It's that they've taken influence from the Arkham, not the Arkham Knight, the Batman games in that.
You can get like twatted by a load of little gobbly things. If there's a load of them at once and they're all coming at you, it's like right, just stop, just and you run away. Apply a little defensive shield and then run back in and set them on fire and try to do some stuff.
Usually it's just getting them in front of you, isn't it? Instead of having them surround you. And it's, there's a lot of tactics to it. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, it's cool.
One other thing I really like about the game as a nice pace changer, and I've heard some criticism of it, is Gwent.
I actually hated it at first because when you first start the game, you get all this like... The game, one of the criticisms I have is the start of the game is massively heavy info dump. Like every time you take a step, it's like, ooh, press this to do this. And you're like, right, okay, then here's a door, do this to this. And you're like, for fuck's sake, here's a sword. And it's like, right, just stopping my gameplay for info every 4 seconds. When you first play Gwent, there's like a 5-minute just explain the rules of Gwent to you. And you're just like, I don't understand.
I still didn't understand it when all this had finished. And I've spent ages playing it. In fact, I spent ages avoiding it and going, fuck this shit. And I've missed loads of unique cards because of it, because I've moved on in the game. And I thought, I'm not going to bother with the Gwent. Not going to bother. But it is actually really cool. And I wish they'd release it separate from the game and have it so you could play other people, because it's brilliant. I love it.
Should we try to explain to Lou what it is?
Gwent is a card game, Lou. Sorry.
It's a card game. And basically, if you to think of... you play an opponent and you have three levels. You've got Siege, which is like really long-range attacks. You've got ranged attack, which is like bows and arrows. And you've got close attack, which is basically swordsman. So you pick a card, like it'll be like a warrior level 1, it'll be like a close combat guy, and you put that down and then your attack power goes to number 1. And the idea is for each round is to get your attack number higher.
Not necessarily. All kinds of... That's the beauty of it.
The highest attack power wins that round.
But you don't have to win a round in order to win the whole set. That's the thing.
No, true. I'll get into that. This is the basic idea of the game. So just basically get a higher attack number and win. But there's all kinds of special cards with loads of special like features. You've got things that, you know, you can draw extra cards out of your deck, you can do things that take a card away and replace it with a dummy. There's all kinds of like weird effects you can do that make the game quite complicated. But the thing is, a lot of it is down to how good your own deck is. You can have good tactics, but if you've got shit cards that are all level 2, then you aren't going to win against somebody who's got a lot of level 10s.
Again, not necessarily, because if they've got all level 10s, but you happen to have some cool special cards in the stuff, like I've there's a few tactics that I've kind of developed over playing various AI characters. Like if someone puts down one of the draw two cards on your deck, what happens if, say, they draw a card and it's got four skill points on it, they can put it down on your deck if it's just one of the particular special cards. Yeah, like a spy, that's what they call them. They put them down on your side. You get the points, but then they get to draw two cards. What you can do is then you can take a decoy card, put the decoy card down over the spy, and you take the spy card, and then you can drop it on theirs and take two cards yourself. So if that happens, like say they drop loads on you and you just so happen to have three decoys, you can take all of the cards and have just as many cards as they've just drawn, you know, so you're on level pegging. But you could draw like a scorch card or so I'm actually really
it's quite
into
deep.
It I'm really
a lot
really
of variation as well. I'm really quite enjoying Gwent. What I'm trying to do is try and get myself a better deck. I'm getting to the point now where I can play a few different things. Like the Northern Realms deck is pretty weak. I try to get my Nilfgaardian Empire one a bit better. And the Monsters one looks like it's probably the best one.
I have literally just opened my second deck up. You've got four decks, Monsters, Nilfgaardian Empire.
Squilex of the day.
Elves, basically. And another one, and I can't remember. But the Monsters one is the hardest to get. I've got a few monster cards, but not many of them. But all of the decks have different characteristics and different types of leaders. And I've only played with the Northern Realms one.
Yeah, that's the one I've been playing with.
But I've got quite a good Northern Realms deck now because I've played a lot. Have you played the Baron yet?
Oh, I had played him. Unfortunately, I finished his questline and didn't get his unique card because he trounced me so hard when I played him. I didn't know that once I'd finished his questline that he'd fuck off.
His unique card's really, really good as well. Yeah, but well, don't say anything, but I finished it in one particular way. I actually posted a link on a picture on my Twitter account as to what happened on my when I finished it the way I finished it.
Oh, that's another thing this game has as well, moral choices. There are a couple of situations where you have to make a decision about what you want to do and who you want to align yourself with. And it's quite a grey area. The one that we're talking about here, in regards to the Bloody Baron in general, neither of the outcomes or neither of the solutions are objectively good in my eyes. It was kind of like I had to pick between the lesser of two evils. Like, which outcome do I think is less bad?
Sometimes as well, I didn't really realise that I was picking an ending when I chose the options that I was choosing. I didn't realise that that's it. That's the end of this particular quest. So
yeah.
What happened on mine, I was a little bit like, I actually walked around the corner. When I saw what had happened, I was like, my heart jumped out of my chest. I was like, get out! But because you'd... Yeah, anyway. I'd invested in characters and stuff, and, you know, it's a bit of a Game of Thrones type thing, throwing it in. Maybe not as much as that, but you know what I mean? It's kind of...
There's a little bit of that in there, actually. And there's just in the sort of world building and the fact that there's families and alliances and history that seems to have been going on for hundreds of years before you ever stepped into this game, which I like as well. Elder Scrolls does that as well. It feels like there's a world that's been going on for thousands of years before you ever got there.
Yeah, yeah.
I like that a lot.
So, is that enough Witcher 3 spoofing?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah. I could literally talk about it all night.
One more thing that I also like, and when I say I like this, it always makes me sound like some sort of psychopath, but I like the fact that there are some really, really cool like dismemberment animations in the game that just really satisfying. Like you fight a load of bandits, and then you get to the last one, and you just go shunk, and you chop him from like here to here, and he's like whole half his body just falls off, and you're just like pwned. They look really cool. I like them quite.
I've become quite. What's it, desensitized to them now, but yeah, when I first started doing them, I was like, oh my god, that's amazing.
Yeah,
brilliant.
So it's nice and violent as well.
So my only other main criticism before we move on is that I am starting now to see duplicated characters, like peasants and that, if you know what I mean. I'm starting to see duplicated faces, and
yeah,
I would have thought, especially Well, I don't know, actually, thinking about it. I would have thought that maybe we would have had some kind of face modding thing, but some of them are just literally copy and pastes of the same peasant.
I don't mind that too much. As long as the actual characters look interesting, and so far all of them have, I don't mind the fact that peasant number 17 appears in a few different places. It doesn't bother me too much.
Yeah, no, that's my only real criticism of the world, though, I mean, in general. Well, apart from... I'm not that keen on the fact that you can't talk to that many people. It's only a very few people that you can talk. I mean, you can go up to someone and, you know, press E or whatever, and they'll say something at you, but that's
it. Start conversation. Yeah, you just go, "Oh, be back soon," or something. You're like, right, whatever.
One thing I was thinking of is doing a playthrough of the game, just to the main quest, of every time someone calls me a name or swears, I might cut them up. Let's just play the game like that and see what happens. Every time, lots of guards call your names and all sorts of stuff. Like witch hunters will be, they'll be all over your ass because you can do magic and that.
Yeah.
Right. Anyway.
That's enough about that.
Yeah, it's enough about that. The Witcher 3, it's brilliant. Buy it.
Yeah, anybody that's not already thought about getting it who may be happening to watch this or not, I don't know, just give it a go. It's really, really, really good.
I've played a few other games, GTA 5 Online, again, been trying desperately to get everybody into that, and I think everyone's lost interest, I have to be honest. I think everyone just can't be asked.
It's just too sparse. There's a huge world with so many things to do, and none of it is fun online.
The heists are going to be fun, but it's just getting everybody together for it. It's just
Have you guys heard of the Honest Trailers thing? The channel on YouTube. They do Honest Trailers for movies. There's also Honest Trailers for games, and they do like they basically like have a guy do like this is the game, the movie voice, and they basically just do like a piss take. Honest, it's like what the game's really like. There's a really funny one for Grand Theft Auto Online that you should check out. It's so true. Like it's honest. Like it just is what the experience is like. Just talks about how you spend most of your time waiting in lobbies or just getting randomly murdered by strangers. All that kind of stuff.
That's pretty much it. I mean, even if you get competent at the game, it's getting from one lobby to another, really, isn't it? And most of the time, you can do it all via menus if you really want to.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's the other thing as well. It's like driving to an event when you could have just gone to the menu to go to the event. It's a bit like, I remember when I was younger and when home computers and PCs were sort of first becoming like a thing that was really common. And, we had a PC in the house, and it had like you had Windows, which was just like just normal there. You select a file and click on it, and there was also like this house, like a 3D house that you had to walk up to something, and if you wanted to get music, you had to walk up to the music cupboard and get it out of the cupboard. It was like just select the file. Do you know what I mean? It's that kind of thing. It's like, why do I have to go around this all this song and dance when I could just click on an icon that is just on a menu? Anyway.
But it is. It's like, I mean, I think there are some missions you have to go to initiate for the first time if you're doing the single player, but you can join anyone else's missions anyway, so it's a bit weird. I don't know if I'll keep playing it. I'm enjoying it, but I want to play it with you guys, and you guys aren't asked, so what's the point? You know?
Yeah, blame us.
Yeah. So I'm level 30-odd or something in there. I've been playing it a fair amount. Right, so yeah, apart from that, because I've been enjoying Gwent so much, I decided to have another go at Infinity Wars, which is a online trading card game, like a Hearthstone kind of competitor. It's obviously nowhere near as popular.
Out of interest, why aren't you playing Hearthstone? Because I thought that would be the big one.
I can't remember where. I think I saw someone, maybe even Josie, playing Infinity Wars on Twitch once, and I thought, oh, that looks all right. It's interesting. I didn't really know about Hearthstone or care that much, rather. I'd heard about it, but I didn't really know what it was. I didn't know it was a card game at the time. Downloaded Infinity Wars and kind of invested a bit of time into it, and that's the only really... that is the only online card game I play. I might play Hearthstone because I think it might be more interesting than Infinity Wars. It doesn't feel very... I don't feel like I want to play it much, you know?
What sort of game is that? I've never played them before.
So, Infinity Wars is... You've got an assault zone and you've got a defense zone, and basically the intention is to build up cards in your assault zone in order to attack the enemy, an enemy's castle or base or whatever. So say you've got three cards in there and they've got an attack of they've got attack and defense, each of them. They've got an attack of 3/3, all three of them, that means that you will deal 6-9 damage if there are no defenders against that castle. If there are defenders, you will deal... The first card will deal 3 damage against the first card in the other side. But if that card's got more defense than 3, so if it's got 9, for example, all three of your cards will die, but that card will die as well because it equals 9. But if it's got 8, then you'll deal 1 damage to the enemy. But if they've got a stack of cards, then it's more complicated, and there's all kinds of modification cards, and it actually really is quite complicated. It may very well be very much like Hearthstone, I don't know. But the same applies on the defense side, so it's just reversed. You know, if you've got special cards as well, you've got commander cards, you've got certain cards that you can, you've got action points. So you have a stack of cards in front of you, and you start off with 1 action point on round 1, 2 on round 2, 3 on round 3. You can boost those at certain points with certain cards, depending on the faction you're playing. But so first round you can only move a level 1 card into your support zone, and your support zone is 1 move. You can't move them from your support zone. So basically the first round, unless you've got a special card, you can't actually attack or defend anything. Again, as with all online trading card games, it can get quite complicated. They keep sending me free cards as well, because I think, again, they're trying to get people to play the game. So I keep having a look at it, but it's just... don't know, it's not, it's, I'd get it, and it's okay, but I don't know if I'm enjoying it, you know.
I've never really been drawn to the online card games, because I just feel like there are games which satisfy that urge better, like XCOM and Chaos Reborn and stuff, like games where you're playing a board game that would be really fiddly to play on a board, whereas the card games aren't fiddly to play because the card games, there's nothing...
Know. Adding everything up and trying to work everything out in certain card games. And I've never played anything like Magic the Gathering or anything, but I know it can get very complicated. I've got a friend who plays it. So I don't know. I don't know. I think there's still a benefit to playing it on your computer. But I said I just don't know about Infinity Wars. I might actually have a play of Hearthstone because a lot of my friends play it.
I've always been bothered by games which actually expose the cards or the pieces, or, you know, like make it feel like you're playing a card game, because the whole point, I always thought, when you're playing a real card game or a real board game, is to pretend you're not playing a board game or a card game. Do you get me?
Yeah, well, that's the thing. Infinity Wars has got a whole... I mean, I'm sure Hearthstone's the same, but Infinity Wars has got a whole lore behind it. If you play the campaign, there's not FMV, there's like comic strips at the beginning of each one telling you what each faction is, and it's like, you know what, I don't care, I want to play the card game, that's what I'm here to play on this particular game. But you're right, I think a lot of people play them for other reasons.
Yeah, I just don't like the idea that a game celebrates its non-computer game heritage. I play a computer game to play a computer game. I want that bit to be hidden from me. I don't want to feel like I'm playing with cards. I want, you know, I'm on a computer. I can actually have real monsters attacking things and wizards and stuff, not a painting on a card. You know what I mean?
It's I get what you mean there.
But it also is just an evolution. You still play board games on PCs. You can still play. I mean, that's all Civilization is, really.
It original. Is, but it's not like a board game. I mean, there's the animated pieces attacking each other. There's never the feeling that you're playing with cards or plastic pieces. You're playing with real things.
This one, I don't know if Hearthstone has all this, but Infinity Wars has animated cards, so you can see what's going on, but it's still a card that you physically pick, you know, drag onto a particular area.
I think there's some people who love cards, and for me... I play a computer game because I want to feel like I'm a little bit closer to doing this for real.
Have you ever been involved in card games in any,
like... I've been involved with Warhammer, and I've also been involved with card stuff. Well, I haven't really been involved with
card game.
I know it's not, but it's a board game, but it's a similar sort of thing that I have the problem with, in that I would rather play a computer game where I'm one step closer to feeling like I'm actually directing a real battle rather than...
Well, no, that's the thing. It's all about. I mean, when I'm playing Gwent in The Witcher, I'm playing it because I enjoy. What do I enjoy? I enjoy the collecting aspect of collecting the cards, going around the world and buying them or winning them off other people. But I also enjoy the tactical side of the card game. It's not that I think that I'm battling people. I mean, I don't actually give a crap if I've got Geralt of Rivia card, which is the only one that's 15, I think. It's the only one with a level 15. I don't know where you get it from, but... but
from there's yourself.
Like, yeah, there's Kiru Metz, level 5, ranged. I care that she's ranged and she's level 5 and she doesn't have any specials. That's all I care about, because that's the tactic. I don't care that it's Kira on it. Mm. I've got no interest in the fact that these cards have got pictures on them, apart from that's just something nice to look at while you're... And it's also a visual cue for me to go, I know that image relates to 5 ranged, you know, maybe?
Yeah.
It doesn't, to me, feel like I'm cheating a computer game. I'm cheating on a computer game, rather, with a game of cards on a computer.
you're being adulterous with the game by playing the game.
It's different. It is a different thing, totally different. It's a card game. It's not a computer game. Anyway, apart from that, Plants vs. Zombies, and I noticed Lou.
Yeah.
You put that
I installed down. It. Yeah, I installed it. I played it on the website. Had a little go to see if I'd like it. And I've got it on my phone now. I put it on my phone a couple of nights ago, and I started playing to the stuff I'd already played. It is great fun, actually.
It's
a very
really
linear, but very... There's still the complexity there, even though you've only got 5 lanes and things just come at you from
how much
one
have you
direction.
Played, though? Because it gets more complex as you play more
I've just started to get... I've just got to the night missions on the computer.
Ah, so have you done the backyard yet? You must have done. That's like level 3 or 4 in. The pool?
No,
with the pool?
No, that, you do the night missions first, the mushrooms.
Okay, so you get basically... Should you want me to tell you all the stuff? I won't spoil the complexity of it, but I'll tell you there's loads of different scenarios you play. I literally today have just completed the main adventure, but you can start again and it's more complicated and you get different scenarios. And plus there's all the different game types as well. It's brilliant. Loads of toilet time spent on that. There's a lot more to it than that. I've just completed it and had to kill a boss as well, and the boss level is insane. Mental. Well, I'm glad you like it. I'm glad someone else likes it.
I'm enjoying it. It's been a while since I played any game on my phone, so it's refreshing, actually. One of the games that I played loads of was a game called Geo Defense, which was a tower defense game, but like it looked a lot like Geo Wars, is it, or something like that. It's all like neon and vectors and stuff. But that was a great tower defense game, really hard, proper hardcore tower defense game. But yeah, I'm enjoying it. I'm enjoying playing something a bit casual.
Did you ever play Ghost Hacker?
No, I didn't.
Ghost Hacker is a tower defense game, which I think you'd quite enjoy. It's a Flash game. You can find it online. It's free. I think it was on Newgrounds years ago. But it's really good, and it's really addictive. Again, it's one of those that I've completed a few times over. Dinner time kind of clicking when I was at work. It's good. I'm still going to be playing Plants vs. Zombies, I think. Not even though I've just completed it, I think I'm going to get around it. I didn't even realise the level I was on was the last level. I actually haven't played it for a week because The Witcher's been taking over everything. I've not actually went to the toilet ever. I've been playing The Witcher since from finishing work.
Oh, you must
until
be backed
that.
Up.
Two in the morning. Do you not see I'm a bit taller?
Another game I've been playing, just because I really love the look of it, and I think it was on offer, is Shadowrun Returns, Dragonfall, Director's Cut.
Mm-hmm.
And I've only played it once, because I've not had time to play it anymore, but it feels like Final Fantasy VII. It's given me the same feeling as Final Fantasy VII, the kind of cyberpunk sort of turn-based battles, the fact that there's no speech and you're reading all the text. It's just, it's proper old school RPG, and I'm actually really enjoying it. Plus it's mixed with the kind of XCOM style combat as well.
Yeah, there's a few bugs in it, but it's the same as the XCOM stuff. It's the combat I really like. I like everything about that game. In fact, I liked, again, character customization. I like the fact that it's not the same as the original Shadowrun, but it's similar enough. But I think the original Shadowrun and the SNES is still my favourite Shadowrun game, because it's got a kind of a dark, eerie feeling to it. And, you know, yeah. I don't know. I even though I enjoy the characters in Shadowrun Dragonfall. Dragonfall's actually the second release. Have you played? You must have the original if you got Shadowrun Dragonfall.
I think it comes with the original as well. But I'm playing... It's in Berlin. I think, yeah, am I playing the original now? Or
no,
that's
Dragonfall.
Right.
You should play the original. If you haven't played it much, play the original first and then go into Dragonfall.
Right.
They don't really relate to each other, but in Dragonfall they refer to a few things in the other game.
Okay.
Make a bit more sense. Plus, they're both... Because they're both so similar in style, look, and mechanics, there's not really a reason not to play the first one. You know, like, normally, like, for example, The Witcher, if I played the first Witcher, it's so far removed from the third one, it's, you know, I can kind of get away with not playing it.
Yeah.
Okay, any other games anyone's played?
I think that's it.
Have you played any more Titan Souls, Sam?
You what, sorry?
You've been playing any more Titan Souls?
No, I've got right to the very end of it and I haven't finished it yet because the boss that I got to was just kicking my ass over and over again. I was like, oh, I'll come back to this later. Then I started playing The Witcher 3 and just haven't gone back to it.
Arkham Knight's out soon as well, so...
Yeah, I know. I do kind of want to go back and finish it. But at the same time, it is one of those games where I kind of feel like, because of the way it was set up, as much as I praised it, having gone through about 25 of these bosses now, or however many I've done, I do feel like I've seen more or less what the game's got to offer. So even if I do finish it, I'm not sure at this stage I'm going to get anything particularly new or different to what I've already done.
That's my exact same feeling about the Unepic stuff, and I haven't even thought about that until just now. I stopped playing it after getting my ass kicked by that boss. I actually only did it about 3 times and just thought, this is shit, I can't be arsed. That particular one boss, and I was like, it's too hard. Fuck it.
I do want to go back to it and finish it. And I haven't finished Hotline Miami 2 either because I kind of got a bit with that game as well.
Yeah, I got to the kind of the Vietnam-esque bit and stopped playing it there. A friend at work has got Bloodborne and he said that it's really hard and he's stuck on the first boss.
I
don't know. There's two bosses
that you can there's a first boss, but there's two that you can access. So the cleric beast is probably the one that he means. There's also a guy called Father Gascoigne who's a lot harder than the cleric beast.
Father Gascoigne.
I know. Yeah.
Where am I, Lake?
A boy is chicken.
I fought Father Gascoigne first and thought he was the first boss to struggle the load. Then I found this cleric beast boss, which was a bit earlier on in the game, but I had bypassed that section because I just hadn't explored it properly. And the first boss is a hell of a lot easier than the second one. But I did the second one first, if that makes sense, so I don't know. Bloodborne is a ridiculously unforgiving game because you can't defend, really. You can only evade. There's no block, there's no...
Right.
There's no shield, and especially if you've played Dark Souls, which is a game that, you know, gives you a shield more or less at the start of the game and says, learn how to block. It sort of makes you play a different way, so... I can understand that. It's very, very unforgiving, but I enjoyed the hell out of that game. I've completed it. And the story's really, really bloody weird, but yeah, I quite like Bloodborne. It is, like, ruthless, but it's good fun.
There's a story recently about a Bloodborne player who beats every boss without leveling up, healing, or using guns.
What a dick. There are some bosses where, like, if you haven't leveled up... Does he level up his weapons, even? Because... Like, it must take about an hour to kill some of the bosses with the low weapons. Your damage is going to be so crap. And if you get one hit off some of the harder bosses, you're going to die. So you must be, like, pretty elite at that game to do that.
Put a link into the chat.
That just made me think about something I read in a latest PlayStation mag. One of the opinion pieces. Somebody said, stop putting RPG elements into every fucking game. And I agree.
It just kind of feel like that. It just kind of feel like they're using that as a way to make it feel like there's more game, doesn't it? I don't want to have a dig at it, but I'm going to bring it up because it seems very relevant in my mind. But the Metal Gear Solid 3 healing stuff seems like one of those things.
I don't know if that
complexity for the sake of it.
That wasn't really... I think at the moment it's trendy to put RPG elements leveling up. Upgrading your weapons, upgrading your character, you know? Whereas if you look at a game, again, I go back to it because it's awesome, but you look at a game like Deus Ex, the original Deus Ex, the only leveling up in that is it rewards you by you finding Bacta canisters in certain areas of the game that you explore. You don't have to level up or experience up or anything like that. You do get money to spend on certain skills and that, but you don't have to do that, you know? You don't have to do that in order to advance in the game. You can continue without doing any of that side quest stuff if you really want. It makes it more difficult, but
I think the leveling up thing, it taps into quite a core need of the part of the sort of hero's journey arc, is that the hero at level one should not actually be the same power level or the same person or the same whatever as they are at the end of the game. You kind of want a progression, and I think leveling up and learning new moves or powers or whatever has that sense of, I started out here and I ended up here, which even in a game that isn't an RPG, I don't mind being given that experience if it's done well. For example, I really like the leveling system that they implemented in Grand Theft Auto San Andreas. They put RPG elements into that game, like your driving skill, your flying skill, that I actually really, really liked, especially the fact that you could go to a school and then spend time training and get those levels up by doing the driving school and the flying school. I really enjoyed that stuff. It was a good challenge, and I thought it did give longevity to the game, but it didn't feel artificial. It felt like something that I wanted to do, or something that I enjoyed doing.
It was natural, though, wasn't it? It's like, again, like the leveling system in Skyrim, in that the more you do something, the better you get at it. And even the more you eat, the fatter you get. You know, the more you go to the gym, the musclier you get. The more you eat and go to the gym, the fatter and musclier you get. I thought that was brilliant.
I love having max fat and max muscle at the same time.
Exactly what I did. Fucking CJ, what?
Put in a six-pack.
Punching someone in the dead. That's brilliant.
It's interesting, actually. I've started using something. I guess you can call it a game, but an app on my phone and a website called Habit RPG. And what that does, it lets you RPG your life. So you give yourself tasks and to-do lists and things like that, and you get experience for it.
Hipster bullshit.
It is hipster bullshit, but it actually kind of works.
No, it doesn't. Shut up.
It does. Go to the gym. The same progress, yeah, but you actually give yourself a reward for going to the gym other than going to the gym.
What a reward. You get a trophy for going to the gym.
You don't get any tangible instant reward when you do something like that. If you brush your teeth, you know that at some point in the future you'll still have teeth. But you don't get an instant reward for that. Right. Whereas this, you brush your teeth.
Stop being a dick then. Brush your teeth and don't have
mangy
teeth.
No, I do brush my teeth. But the point is that this gives you instant gratification. And I think that's what these RPG things do. They give you an instant gratification. When you level up, that is an instant gratification.
It's puppy dog selling. It's giving you something that doesn't mean anything. It means nothing at all.
But it's still a reward. It still gives you a reward, whereas a lot of things won't give you a reward. A lot of things, if you don't get a tangible reward, you find it hard to stick with them. And that's how it works, and that's how RPGs work, and that's why, I guess, one of the reasons why RPG elements are introduced into games is to make them so that you have tangible rewards that aren't difficult for the programmers to put in the game. It's just a simple ding, you've leveled up, because you arbitrarily get points for killing things or something. It's an easy way to add more reward to the game.
Mm. I understand what you're saying.
I get that, but playing a game is reward enough, surely. I mean, you're playing a game, you're getting enjoyment out of it. I don't want to have to grind and level. And I mean, that's the thing. Most of the time, you have to grind in order to get anywhere, in order to level up, unless, as Sam says, unless it's done really well and is part of the natural flow of the game, that's fine. I don't mind that. But having I bring up Assassin's Creed, Far Cry 3, that kind of thing, where even though Far Cry 3 was wonderful, it still had an element of, right, I'm going to have to go and, you know, grind a few levels before I can do this camp or whatever, you know? I don't want that.
I didn't have a problem with that in Far Cry 3. I didn't ever. I never went grinding.
But alright, maybe not, but there were still arbitrary missions that you had to do in order to upgrade your inventory, and if you wanted to get the max carry weight or the max amount of syringes or all of the syringes, you had to go and do all the shit missions that you...
It was a lot easier in that than it was in Far Cry 4. I remember there was an animal that was on the map that wasn't actually where the map said it was, and so I couldn't get this stupid thing that I needed.
Yeah, I remember feeling like that quite a lot in Far Cry 4. That like the things that I wanted to do, the hunting things, were just annoying and felt tedious, and they didn't feel tedious in Far Cry 3.
Yeah,
I don't know why that is. I think it's because it was just exactly the same, maybe. Maybe. I don't know.
It was exactly the same, but it was just harder because the animals were more sparse.
There is that, but I feel like I could go back and play Far Cry 3 and enjoy it. Whereas the fact that Far Cry 4 feels like a rip-off makes me not want to play it, even though it's the same thing. I don't know, that's stupid to me, because I should enjoy it if it's more of the same, but I enjoy Far Cry 3 more. I like the soundtrack in Far Cry 4 better. because I didn't. The Far Cry 3 felt very dated already. It's got that sort of like when you're going through the woods, you've got like wub wub wubs on your back, and you're going through the jungle, and you're like, I don't need that in my life. It's not appropriate for that kind of. I understood what it was doing in the game, but I don't think it's an appropriate soundtrack choice for a game like that.
Can I ask you both a question then before we move on to the next section? Do you enjoy grinding in every game? Because that is the general thing that's happening these days. That's the way it's going. Apparently,
depends if the grind is enjoyable.
Sorry, Sam.
But generally, no, I don't enjoy grinding. Grinding just to do levels, no. I don't mind progressing by doing the things that I was going to do anyway that I wanted to do. If that gets me progression, then yes. If it's just like, I'm going to have to go into this cave, kill some shit, come out, go back in and kill them again so I can get some XP, then no. Now, never enjoy that.
What about you, Lou?
I will say, I have done it for hours and hours in certain games. I've done it in EverQuest. I did it in Final Fantasy VII. I spent ages in a sunken plane.
Can I just say, RPGs are fine. That is what an RPG is. I'm talking about adding grinding RPG elements into every fucking game under the sun.
No, that can fuck off.
Because, I mean, you look at, again, I take Assassin's Creed as a perfect example. Huge, beautiful worlds, done in a really, I mean, nice combat systems, you know, well, generally, you know, interesting items and stuff, but you have to grind, even though you're not grinding a level, you have to grind the game to death in order to open up certain things, or just to get all the feathers and get an achievement.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, there's people that trophy hunters that go through these games and want to get all the bronzes, all the silvers, all platinum and all and everything. I can't be arsed with any of that, and I never have been bothered about that. But I do like an achievement. I do like going, yep, you've done well. I don't like grinding for hours and hours playing a game with something that isn't a challenge to get an achievement. I want something that is hard to do. You know, it's like when I say that and I'm playing The Witcher and I'm doing all of the side missions, but I'm doing all of the side missions and thoroughly enjoying every single one of them. Every single one's different. Every single, even though you do have to go into a cave and kill something or follow the same trail of sweets to the next monster, you know, it's the same thing each time, but it's really enjoyable somehow they make it. It feels like it's part of the natural part of the game, you know?
Mm.
Okay.
It depends. I don't like it being shoehorned or crowbarred into stuff, but I don't think anybody does.
No, just to extent. But we keep buying these games and keep playing them, and keep grinding them, don't we? I mean, the last Assassin's Creed I played, I still hammered it. I mean, I didn't go for all the flags, you know, and all the feathers, but I went for pretty much everything else, all of the items that I wanted in order to complete my armor collection or to, you know, save all my swords and make sure all my paintings in the in Montenegro Castle or whatever it was called, you know what I mean, the house, I wanted to make sure all the rooms were filled for no reason, absolutely no reason whatsoever, apart from it all looks shiny.
But you never want to actually go there other than to just get another sword out of your cupboard or whatever.
But I never want to play those games again, ever.
Off the top of my head, Terraria was the last game I played where I did grind in.
I didn't grind in Terraria.
Well, we did sort of grind. I mean, we ground the bosses, didn't we, for a while? We ground, like, the Eater of Worlds or whatever it was.
Yeah.
So we did do a bit of grinding in that, and we built that whole hell platform just to fight it. That was kind of grinding.
That was to me,
loot
that
farming.
Was... Yeah, I wasn't even doing it for loot, though. I was doing it so I was building that platform so I could kill the boss in an easy way. But I wasn't necessarily...
That's kind of grinding?
I think that was building something to achieve a goal. I mean, it's an RPG again, though, so it's still going to have some element of grinding in it, but...
I can't actually think of a game that I played that's not an RPG where I've done grinding in it. But then again, I've not played a lot of these recent games that have had those elements in them.
Apparently The Crew, which is a car game, has got grinding in it. I can't remember exactly what, but you have
there's actual angle grinding on your car.
And there's also, I mean, look at GTA Online. That is basically grinding.
A lot of grinding.
To get nothing. Absolutely nothing, apart from, I don't know, a better car or an apartment. And then once you've got the apartment, you can then do the heists. And then once you've got the heists all unlocked, there's no reason to do that apart from to get money, to get better weapons, to improve. And what's that? I mean, having a better weapon in GTA 5 doesn't make that much difference. As long as you've got an automatic gun of some sort, you can kill people, you know? Mm. Pistols, yeah, fair enough. You need to upgrade those a bit because they're a bit hard to shoot people, but... Give us more, less open worlds and less huge, huge games and more like interesting content. That's what I'm screaming for here.
More unique experiences and less just generic open world. Go and do the thing, then go to the next area and do the thing again.
More love by the developers, I think.
We are kind of encouraging this sort of behavior from developers, or by the way that people go apeshit about like procedurally generated games, because I think it's going to have infinite fun in it because it's infinitely infinite. It doesn't work like that, but we still fall for it every time. I mean, did you see the footage of the Lego game that's come out on Steam and Early Access? So the Lego have released a game, basically. It's an official Lego game, which is basically Minecraft with Lego.
Oh, I see. Because I was going to say, there's been plenty of Lego games. There's been Lego Batman, Lego Star Wars, Lego.
The same company that's done that stuff has now made a Lego Minecraft.
Okay.
So you can build your own worlds and stuff. People have been going crazy over it. It was trending like on social media, non gaming stuff, and like people have played Minecraft. Minecraft's been out for ages. Minecraft probably does it better than that game. It's got multiplayer for a start. The Lego one doesn't.
Minecraft isn't an RPG though, and there's no grinding in it. It is
no, but
building.
What I mean is, it's not so much the grinding. It's the fact that people are buying into what you were just talking about there, about the idea of games giving you lots of unique, interesting content. People think that a procedural game will give them lots of unique, interesting content, and it won't. It'll give them lots of procedural content, which isn't unique or interesting. Well, it's unique, but it's not interesting.
What's interesting about Minecraft and Terraria and Planet Explorers and all the other builder games is the building and the creating your own thing, and that's what they do. They give you a toolkit to create your own thing. It isn't a game as such, apart from when people spend years or months or whatever building their own servers and then opening it up to the public, and then they can go on there and, you know, like, look at something like Garry's Mod, for example. Garry's Mod is still extremely popular, and I still know people who play it now, and all it is a sandbox game that people can build whatever they want in, and then build mods for Half-Life, essentially. And then all these game types come out of it, and people enjoy them. I mean, that murder that I played, it was brilliant. Loved it. It's a good bit of fun. All made in a sandbox game. Not by a developer, probably by some... Actually, I'm not sure who made murder, I have to be honest, but probably just made by some guy in his bedroom one night who had an idea for something. Anyway. Right, so should we move on? Should we move on to the next section?
Yeah.
Which is the Way of the Exploding List.
That was detritus falling from the... yes!
Yeah,
yes!
I didn't think of that, did you?
Why, yes!
You're going to write a post-it for next week.
Shake camera.
You only did this and you go, whoa!
Get some Star Trek on it.
The thing is, Steve's not here, so he'll be on and he'll be like, what the fuck are you all doing?
We won't tell him either.
No, don't tell him.
I've got an idea for a list this time.
Cool. I've got three written
for
down.
The first time.
There was one from a guy last week. Can't remember who said it. I'm sorry if it's anybody in the chat today. And if it's not anyone in the chat, then fuck off. I can say them if you want.
Yes, it was last week, but it did 2 weeks ago. So
Last time. Last episode.
Someone said favourite soundtracks. I'm not sure if we've done
that. I was thinking that. We haven't done it because we talked about this a while ago. We're going, well, if we can't play the music, then how can we talk about it? But I think we can still talk about it.
Well, it was dead good, that. I liked the bells.
Yeah.
There is a game where I like the bells.
We can still talk about a soundtrack and say what we liked about it.
Shall we do the soundtrack then? And I'll hang on to mine for a bit longer.
If you want. I mean, I can't think of soundtracks off the top of my head, but... I can. Gears of War, the soundtrack Gears of War.
We're doing soundtracks then, are we? Because you've started now, haven't we?
All right, then, fuck hell. What are we doing?
Soundtracks, let's do game soundtracks.
All right, okay, then. I can't think of any.
Gears
of
War.
Yes, you can. obviously we're going to say Final Fantasy VII, because I spent the best part of the first half of my like childhood and PC owning time trying to find the soundtrack on MP3 and got it on MIDI in various formats that people had done played on the keyboards themselves. Final Fantasy VII soundtrack is amazing.
Wasn't it mod originally?
It was actually PSF, but it's a PlayStation mod format. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. It was a mod format, and then on the PC it was WAV format, and it was full orchestra, wasn't it? Well, full,
it was MIDI
full,
on the PC.
Full synth orchestra, yeah. So MIDI yeah. and stuff. No, I'll agree with you there, because I've listened to the soundtrack on that a lot.
I agree as well. I've not played the game as much as you guys have, but the music, even though on the PlayStation version it's very, very clearly MIDI, it's still very, very good music. It's still, as in the compositions and everything, it's still really good.
Oh, the PlayStation version is the best version, I think, by far.
It sounds very... I think that soundtrack, given when it came out, that there were other games that were around at that time that were using real like live instruments and orchestras on the PlayStation, and that game sounded very, very MIDI. I'd say the quality of that is quite low, but the music itself is very, very good.
Yeah.
That's what I'd say.
The quality of music never puts me off, and that's why I one of my favourite pieces of music of all time, not just in gaming, is the RoboCop soundtrack from the Sinclair Spectrum, specifically the high score theme music, which is just amazing, which is used on the Ariston advert.
Okay.
It's not Oxygen, is it?
No, it's not, no.
There's a game on the Commodore 64 which used, it was called...
Chamashaja.
Yeah, but it was, what was the game called? Zenith. Oh my god. Shit, I've forgotten it. Totally forgotten it. But it was this little robot you had to fly around in space, and it was rock hard, as with every Commodore 64 game. And you did about two screens and then exploded. That was basically the game.
A soundtrack that I've got to mention is the score and the soundtrack for Red Dead Redemption. It's so good. Like, it's so perfectly evocative of the atmosphere that they were going for. You've got that really, really strong... Fistful of Dollars, Ennio Morricone, like, tile, like, down, 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 like, twangy guitars, and then, like, whistles and stuff and all that. It's so good when you're riding through, like, some wilderness, and you've got that, like, down, 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 like, really cool guitar. It feels like you're playing The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly, the video game or something. It's really mint. Such a good soundtrack.
Corpse has mentioned Lotus Turbochange too, and many of the Amiga soundtracks. I mean, I'm gonna throw one back to you, Corpse. I'm going to say Cannon Fodder. When my Amiga was singing to me, that's when I knew I was in the future. That's when I knew hoverboards were just around the corner. And
well,
it's still not.
We get to October this year, we'll have to know one way or the other.
Yeah. Recent games, soundtracks.
Well, I said I'm going to say all of the Gears of War games. It was Steve Jablonski that did it. Steve Jablonski, yeah. Jablonski. But I enjoyed. I didn't just enjoy the soundtrack. I enjoyed the games entirely and the story for all the way through the Gears of War games. I think they're one of those that you have to invest in order to really appreciate it. But no, the soundtrack just kind of added to it, I think, and I like that kind of epic. I would put it in the same catchment as the Metal Gear Solid type stuff.
I can't remember any of the Gears of War soundtrack at all.
I can't think of a single tune or anything.
It's more of the general theme of it, I think, that I'm talking about. It's got that kind of epic feel to it, I think, that kind of long journey kind of feel, you know.
Speaking of which, I'm going to say that the Metal Gear Solid soundtracks generally are very good. I think that the stuff Harry Gregson Williams has done, really cool. Lots of really cool, like, sneaking stuff, the fast-paced action stuff, like, always been impressed by the soundtracks to those games.
Nobu Uematsu, wasn't it, the guy who did Final Fantasy?
Uematsu. Yeah, Nobu Uematsu.
Yeah.
I haven't actually got it anymore. I wish I did. Lost it.
Clearly a very talented musician. Another game that I want to throw out as a really, really great soundtrack, Tenchu Stealth Assassins had one of the best soundtracks of any game I've ever played in my life. Like, each level had its own song, its own piece of instrumental music, but there were some of them were really, really cool. Like, particularly the one for the level one of Tenchu's Death Assassins is is actually a piece of media that I like so much. I've got it on my iPod and play it frequently. Like, it's just this really, I can't really describe it, but it's really, really well made music, like acoustic guitars, real violins and stuff like that. It's really, really well put together soundtrack.
Check that out. Someone's mentioned Mario, or Cobb's mentioned the Mario music. Now, I always thought the Mario music was kind of catchy but bland. But the Sonic the Hedgehog, the soundtracks for all of the original Sonic games.
No, I have to say that I am a Sonic like defender type person, but I've got to give Mario is as good as, I mean, that, I mean, you, that, probably one of the most recognizable pieces of music to anybody from our generation.
The Tetris music, obviously, it's iconic.
Isn't that an old, like, isn't that like an old, yeah, it's an old Russian folk song, isn't it?
Yeah. Halo as well, Mario O'Donnell, the Halo soundtrack. Halo's soundtracks are brilliant.
Halo the general even exist to me.
But the soundtrack's great, though, you've got to admit. When they got Breaking Benjamin in or something, or whatever it is, to do some
Breaking
music
Benjamin. For it.
Go off with...
We're gonna whine about something! It's basically all that, what that music is to me. But yeah, the main theme to Halo is brilliant. It's an awesome theme tune.
The main
really
theme
cool.
to a lot of games are brilliant. I mean, the Star Fox main theme, for God's sake. You know? Mm. There's all kinds of main themes that are brilliant, but I think we're talking about soundtracks.
I know.
The whole feeling. I mean, Far Cry 3 had a really good soundtrack in general, but again, it was. I think Brian Tyler did that. It was again another epic type, long journey type thing. That's the only way I can describe those kind of soundtracks. But the problem is a lot of games do them. A lot of games have that kind of. A lot of the big games have that kind of thing in them. I'm not sure if that's a good thing. Or not.
Two modern games that really had really good soundtracks that have stood out have been. Wolfenstein: A New Order. That's a fantastic soundtrack, really different, and also the Borderlands 2 music.
Mm.
Yeah,
some of the tracks in that are fantastic.
Oh, another game that I've talked about before has just been one of my like personal loves. The Soul Reaver games had really cool, really creepy, weird electro sort of soundtrack that was really haunting and sort of dark and disturbing, which kind of fit the tone of the game perfectly. Lots of like down, da, da, down, da, da, down, like really ominous synths and stuff in the background. That was really atmospheric soundtrack. Because there's a soundtrack that you can listen to on its own as a piece of music, and then sometimes there are soundtracks that I think are evocative of an atmosphere. And I think those Legacy of Kain ones really fit the mood of the game, like they really fit with the scenery. You might want to listen to them on their own as a piece of music, but as a companion piece of the game, they're really good.
I listen to quite a lot of game music on its own, and I've actually got into games from listening to the soundtrack. A lot of the time, I'll like Humble Bundle for a while. I don't know if they're still doing it, but they used to give you soundtracks for the indie games that they'd publish. And one of the games that they brought out, and I think I've mentioned it before. I think we've talked about soundtracks before at some point. I'm sure we have. There's a game called Mutant Muds. The game is a pretty bland kind of 2D shooter platformer with kind of an element of, you can go, if you press up in certain places, you can go into the background and then come back into the main area. Mm. The game didn't do much for me itself, but the soundtrack was amazing. It was just like a really cool, like 8-bit kind of, just had a lot of chunk to it, and I played the game from listening to the soundtrack. The name of the game sounded a lot more interesting than it was as well. There's another one as well, Gunpoint, the game.
Gunpoint, yeah, I've got some of the soundtrack. I think you might even sent me some of the Gunpoint tunes.
Me?
Chris. I'm sure it was you who sent me them, yeah, because I've got them.
Maybe. I don't know. But anyway, the thing I like about the Gunpoint soundtrack is, one, the composer for my game wrote it, and two, the... What they've got is, you know, when you go into Gunpoint is a 2D sleuth 'em up, essentially. It's kind of like you're this little agent with a little hat on, and you've got you basically jump around on a level and try and get into buildings and hack things and do cool stuff. But you can go into, if you press tab, you can go into a rewire mode, and the rewire mode allows you to kind of drag wires from like light switches to lights and put them onto You can attach a light switch to a plug socket, for example, and then that'll electrify an enemy if you turn the plug socket on, if you turn the light switch on. Or you can attach it to a door and a door will open, or you can attach it to relays or lights, and if you turn the lights out, then the enemies can't see for a few seconds, and they'll run and turn a light switch on, and then when they turn the light switch on, they might get electrified from it being plugged into the light socket. So it's quite cool. But when you go into the rewire mode, it's the same theme, but it's kind of like a dumbed down low pass filter version of it. It isn't actually just a low pass filter. I've actually spoke to Ryan Ike, the guy who did the soundtrack, about it, and asked him how he did it. And he rewrote the entire thing for it, but it just sounds like they've just applied.
So it's like behind the scenes music. Yeah, like I like that.
It's really, really clever, and I really liked it. And one of the reasons I actually, when he approached me, I decided to go with him for our game, because he's obviously got a bit of imagination there, and I really loved it. Really loved that little twist. And it's just it's just a 2D platform. Every level's got its own music as well, but it's all very similar. And each level has the two versions, because in every level you can go into this rewind mode.
Oh, I've got two more examples, unless you want to go next, Lee.
I was just going to say I'm a big fan of game music in general. I'm not afraid to admit it. I've got it on my phone and stuff like that. I've got a whole collection of Sid music on my phone. One more that I want to give a mention to, because some people probably don't even realise it's got a soundtrack, is Quake 2. Music on Quake 2 is brilliant.
Yeah.
Really, really cool. Sonic Mayhem, heavy guitar stuff.
So is the Quake 1 music.
Well, that's Trent Reznor, isn't it? But that's all very ambient stuff.
But I mean,
but the Quake 2 is really pumping sort of electronic metal.
If we're talking about ambient, there's still a soundtrack, Antichamber. You probably don't remember any of that if you've played that.
I haven't played it. It's one of those games where you can't bind the keys.
You know, you can't. That's the point. That was one of the things he wanted to do with that game, is to take away all of the tropes of games and kind of throw you into anyway, but the soundtrack for that is just ambience all the way through, and some bits you'll walk into an area and the soundtrack will change depending on, sometimes it'll be giving you clues to how to solve a puzzle. Because there's lots of other clues as well for other things, but that's the thing about it. It's all kind of blended into the game, and it feels creepy in some places, and other places it feels like you're in a forest, but you're not actually in a forest. It's really weird. It's really good, though. If you haven't played Antichamber, play it. It's awesome.
What you've sounded, told me, it does sound like it's the kind of game I would love to give a go to.
It's a Portal type, it's that kind of awesomeness. Yeah. It's different.
Speaking
very different.
Of which, I was actually really impressed by the very minimalist and subtle way that the soundtrack was used in Portal 2, in that the soundtrack would only sort of trigger as you were solving the puzzle. Like, there was, if you set up, let's say you had to set up a springboard and then go through a portal and do a thing. As you started to set off your little thing, the soundtrack would start piping up behind you as you were doing it.
And if
that
you
was
failed,
awesome. It made you feel really satisfied. Once you got to if it failed, it just stopped. You got to the other end, it was like, yeah, this little soundtrack had sort of guided you on your way there as well as you were moving. I thought that was really cool the way they did that. It was so clever, and you almost might not have noticed it unless you were looking out for it in a way. Like, yeah, I didn't really clock it was doing it until after a few levels.
No, I did get that, because it feels some bits, like if you go into one of some of the Ratman areas as well, the soundtrack changes into this kind of underground kind of beat type. It sounds like a lot of extended kind of beats and stuff. It's again cool. I like people that do things like that with sound. I think more interesting than someone writing an awesome piece of music. Being able to fit it in with the game and make it feel like organically part of the game, I think that's a real skill. A real skill.
It is. That was really cool. But then I can't talk about soundtracks without mentioning the awesome, awesome Shadow of the Colossus soundtrack as well, which is not that at all. That is literally like you climbing a monster and this huge orchestra goes, da, 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 da. And you're like, yeah, so good. That's the opposite end of the spectrum, where the orchestra just kicks you in the face with how awesome it is.
Do you like that game?
I can't not notice. I love Shadow of the Colossus.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's great.
It's the same as me mentioning Metal Gear Solid and Quake 2 every bloody episode. You talk about that every episode. And Legacy of Kain as well.
I love Legacy of Kain and Shadow of the Colossus, and I will never shut up about them.
Good. Right. Possibly exhausted the old soundtrack stuff.
We haven't exhausted it, but I just don't want to talk about it for the rest of the show. We do a whole show on it, I think. Let's revisit that, because there's so much more to talk about.
Maybe, if you're lucky. Right, so let's get on to the gaming news, rumours, releases, things. One thing I haven't put in here that I just read something about that I think may be interesting is the new Rainbow Six game that's coming out, Rainbow Six Siege. Sounds really, really cool. Now, I've been reading about it, and essentially it's the same, similar kind of concept to other Rainbow Six games, where I think Siege is, I think there's a, it might even just be an online multiplayer game, I'm not sure, but it's very, very, very focused on co-op by the sounds of it. So essentially you've got 60 seconds at the beginning of a round to set up, there's people, I'm not sure who's the goodie and who's the baddie, I didn't get that far into reading the review or whatever it was, but the there's a set of people that are looking after a hostage, essentially, or a number of hostages, and there are a set of people who are trying to get that hostage one way or the other. Now, I don't know which way around it is. I think there's I think it's slightly different in that the invaders are the bad guys, and the people who are looking after the hostage are the good guys. You know, like they're the counter-terrorists type thing. So you've got 60 seconds at the beginning of a round. The people, the invaders, are setting up cameras and putting cameras under doors and setting them up in strategic places on the world. And they've got these little buggies or whatever, these little drones that they have to try and find the hostage and locate the hostage. Each of the members of each team have a specific skill. So one guy, for example, has got an iPad and he's got like a motion tracker on it. And then there's another guy who's a breacher, who's got a sledgehammer that knocks doors down and stuff, and there's another guy who's a sniper or an assault guy, or, you know, there's some tropes in there, but there's also some quite interesting ideas. But there's also the fact that you can put breach charges almost anywhere in the level, and it will affect the level, in that you, and by the sounds of it, you have to work very closely together in order to like actually achieve your goal. You have to work as a team. And the thing that the reason I mention it is because I think it might be quite a cool game for us to play if it comes out on PC. I'm not sure if it is on PC.
I'd be up for that.
It's definitely on PS4, definitely. But I'm not sure about PC.
The gameplay footage that I saw had them doing a breach on somebody's house, where there was one team was holding the family hostage, and the other team was playing the
counter-terrorists.
The counter-terrorists trying to get them out, and that looked like it could be really good fun. I would be intrigued to see how strong the one-player campaign on that is, because I generally like to play games one-player, but that looks like it's built towards the multiplayer, so maybe not. But I quite like the Rainbow Six games. The Rainbow Six Vegas games were really good and tense. You had to sort of plan what you were going to do and then execute it well, otherwise you were going to die.
And just ran into a room screaming and spraying bullets everywhere just for fun. And somehow pulling it off sometimes as well. And other times everything failing miserably and I was having to restart again. Or other times all the sounds on the planet playing in your ears at once.
That's my memory of the game. Is all the sounds on the level that I've ever played continuing to play over and over.
Yeah, so I mean, I like the look of it, and I think we should probably have a go of it and see what the reviews are like. But I think it may be a good game to get on. I think you've got these 60 seconds at the beginning of the round as well. One team can set up cameras. When you die, you know, like in Counter-Strike, when you die, you're dead. You go into observer mode or whatever, and you can't talk to anybody, etc. But in this one, the focus is once you're dead. You can, if those cameras haven't been decommissioned by the other team, you can view through the cameras and you can speak to your team members and tell them where people are. And I don't know what the premise is for that, but it's supposed to be part of the game, you know, built into it. So you can still help your team after you're dead. And it's only if those cameras still in commission. Otherwise, you can't do it. So, you know, it's your prerogative to set them up in the right place. The other team, the team that's looking after the hostage or looking after the people or whatever, they have 60 seconds to place themselves and place the hostage or hostages in certain rooms and set it all up. So it's the hardest. Oh, and they can also block certain doors. So you can choose kind of which you can like choke the enemy into a certain area. However, there are breach charges you can use that can open up different areas. So there's also potential for shooting people through walls and stuff as well. So you can, it really sounds cool. Anyway, I'm up for that. Mm. Up for that if you are.
Yeah.
There okay. came an echo. Whose is this?
Yeah, this is mine. So it's a turn-based strategy game. Actually, I don't think it's turn-based. I think it's actually real-time, but it's unique and it's controlled by voice. So you actually give vocal orders to the team. You're basically like an overseer and you tell people where to go. So move to Alpha Point and things like that. Looks really interesting. Now, but the reason that I found this was because of the soundtrack, which is by Big Giant Circles, who did some of the Borderlands 2 soundtrack. Soundtrack is unbelievably good. Really good.
I'm skeptical of voice command games. I played a game called Binary Domain on the 360, which was voice controlled squad commands. And although it was okay, it still felt a bit cumbersome. And I still didn't feel comfortable really shouting at my TV. You know, saying, can you go and, you know, throw a grenade here? It worked, don't get me wrong, sometimes when the Kinect was hearing me properly. But I don't know.
It does say that beware if you've got a regional accent.
Yeah, I know.
It basically understands you if you're from like Middle America. If you're not, then you're going to struggle.
So if you start giving it hardcore Brummy or Glaswegian, you shit out of luck.
Exactly, yeah. You're just going to the characters will shoot themselves and the game will end.
You can't go down there, man. What?
Yeah.
But yeah, they check out the soundtrack. I mean, we've just been talking about soundtracks. That's a fantastic soundtrack. You can listen to it on their Bandcamp. It's really, really looks good.
Looks interesting.
Sounds good.
Cool. Have you put a
the next chat? One? I put it there.
I'll do that.
Sorry. Yeah. The next one. This has probably been around a while, but you can play over 2,500 DOS games online now in a browser-based emulator. And there's stuff on there like the original Metal Gear, and Prince of Persia, Wolfenstein 3D, all sorts of crazy stuff. The original Civilization's in there as well.
Is that free?
They're all free to play in your browser right now.
That's awesome. Right, that's getting bookmarked. When I finish playing The Witcher to death.
Yeah,
there's some great games in there, some proper classics. It's not just some crappy public domain stuff, it's big games, big names, Street Fighter 2 and SimCity.
Really?
Wow. Yeah. Dune 2, which is Lemmings 2, The Tribes.
Oh, I love that game. I could go for some Lemmings, I've played that for literally decades.
Batman Returns, Maniac Mansion! Oh my god!
It's pretty cool. And that's set up actually by archive.org, who do the Wayback Machine, so that's like a preservation thing. It's officially sanctioned preservation for these games.
Oh, you've lost me cool, now. This is all legal, it's not going to go anywhere or anything.
Yeah,
like that.
This is legal. This is like I say, it's archive.org who run the Wayback Machine.
That's
nothing
awesome.
Kind of grey area, this is completely above the board.
Hugo's House of Horrors!
Chris may just have ejaculated.
These are all the old adventure games that I literally cut my teeth on when I was a kid.
Monkey Island as well.
Oh my god, Roadrunner! I forgot that even existed. Caveman Olympics.
So that's quite good.
Yes, sorry for cutting the show. That's amazing.
And someone had the audacity to accuse us of being professional in the week. Is it?
Oh, right.
Anyway, that's worth a look.
Close
the link.
That's tonight, that is. Tomorrow.
It's a day. Anyway, yeah.
Yes, next. Chip Challenge 2! Do you remember Chip Challenge 1?
I remember the original Chip Challenge. Yes, I do. It's about a guy who's like,
in his
trying
computer.
To find his girlfriend or something, isn't he?
Yeah. He's apparently in his computer and he just goes around collecting. It's just a little puzzle game, but it was back. I think I played it on the Commodore. I think it was on the Commodore 64. Could have been the Amiga on a mate's computer, but I remember playing it.
It was on Sinclair Spectrum, so I've been on the Commodore 64.
Yeah, I remember playing it to death when I was a kid. But Chip Challenge 2 was developed over 2 years, apparently, and it didn't get released because the license was owned by somebody else. But this is the original version after many years of this guy trying to get the license back to himself. He's released it on Steam now. So I just think it's worth a... I might even buy it just because it's for, you know, for retro kind of kicks and giggles, shits and giggles type thing, you know?
Atari published it originally, so I guess those guys had all of it.
I have no idea. It doesn't necessarily mean the publisher had the copyright or whatever. I think it was licensing, though. I don't think it was a copyright issue. I don't know.
Right. Vladimir Gerechki. Sorry if I'm mispronouncing that. It looks very old school.
Yes, well, it looks like it's the original game, just released on modern computers. Don't know how that works, so you must have slowed it down somehow or sped it up.
Sorry, there's the DOS library. People were asking for it in
Sorry, I was so excited looking at it. I didn't even paste it in there. But yeah, I'll put a link in for Chip's Challenge as well. Next, Twitch has banned adult-only games. Do we care? Now, bear
so
in mind that...
you can't stream adult-only games. Does that mean that you can't stream The Witcher?
No.
Adult-only.
No, adult-only is a very, very small, obscure list of Japanese titles. This is adult-only. This is the AO ESRB rating for America.
Right. Okay, yeah.
So it's a very, very, very small list of titles. Now, the controversy surrounding this specifically surrounds Hatred, this new game. This is the adult-only game. You remember us talking about it a few weeks ago?
Columbine simulator, basically, isn't it?
I'm not sure, I'll be honest, but I didn't look into it too much, but it looks ultra-violent and ultra-nasty. But this is people obviously responding to this going, oh, Twitch are banning Hatred, why can't they just ban Hatred instead of banning all AO games? But the only other game that's worth really mentioning that's an AO game is GTA San Andreas Hot Coffee Mod. And that was only because you could have sex in it.
You can have sex in The Witcher. So why?
The sex scenes in The Witcher is one of those like, they're not really. It's just boobs in it and stuff, but it's not massively explicit. It's nothing more than you get in like a Basic Instinct or something. Do you know what I mean? It's not like it's really super hardcore or anything like that.
Yeah.
It's just weird how if you depict it in games, it's seen as being way worse than putting it in a movie, which is ridiculous.
It is ridiculous. Even in
a game like The Witcher 3, they still look weird and awkward, like two mannequins bashing against each other. It still seems weird and awkward. They've never got it right in a computer game ever.
To this day, I'll always cite Duke Nukem 3D being an 18-rated game is ridiculous. I mean, there isn't even boobs in it.
It's because it's violence towards women, that's what it is. It's because you can boot the women, the strippers. That's what it is. That's the reason that it got the adult rating. Or whatever it was, 18 rating. Well, it's ridiculous to you, but everyone else in the world probably
is. So you can kill men in games, but if you kill a woman, then who knows?
Well, if you kill a woman in the wrong context, I think this is a sexualized, you know...
I think going and kicking a stripper to death is maybe worse than shooting a bloke who's shooting at you.
Yeah.
I guess that's the thing. Now, I personally think it's kind of a weird line to draw. Because aren't some of those women aliens or something in Duke Nukem?
They're all infected, yeah. You kill them, and when you kill them, actually, it spawns more enemies. But yeah, they've all been... They all say, kill me, because they're all, like, getting turned into aliens.
Yeah.
But apart from the strippers actually aren't just aliens. They're just strippers.
Can you kill the strippers,
You
can, no, you
yeah,
can.
Yeah, you can. If you kill the strippers, it spawns enemies as well.
Right.
If you kill any of the innocents in Duke Nukem, and you spawn extra enemies.
Any of the innocent sprites that just do that as you move around them. Sorry. But anyway, what? Honestly, what do you think about this though? Even if this was an 18 thing, if they were banning UK 18 games, would you have a problem with that?
Twitch have they have an audience, don't they? And they have a reputation to uphold, I guess. And they probably want to nip this in the bud before it goes too crazy and people start streaming all sorts of shit.
Yeah, no, you're right.
I guess any broadcaster like Twitch, which it is basically a broadcaster, has to basically reach this point where they get popular enough to have to draw the line. It's like, I think you used to be able to upload porn and stuff to YouTube, although it get deleted when someone found it.
Yeah.
YouTube now have had to really try and crack down on that, and now they've got loads of automation in place when they got big enough to for it to be a problem and for their reputation to be possibly damaged by it.
Yeah.
So I guess they're making the same move to anyone, but it's just growth, isn't it?
I'm behind it, to be fair. I mean, by the sounds of it, this Hatred game is pretty nasty, like, gratuitously so. It's not just a game, it's more of a statement.
It seems like the game, and it could be that they're doing this on purpose, but it seems like the game is just sadistic for the sake of being sadistic. And I'm not, if it turns out that there's something more going on with it, then I'll give it benefit of the doubt. But all the promotional material that they've put out basically seems to be, this is a game where you just get to go and murder everybody for the sake of murdering everybody without even the pretense of getting money or something like in Grand Theft Auto. It's just, no, I want to kill innocent people because I want to kill innocent people.
I do believe they are making a statement with it. I think it is a statement towards censorship and stuff like that.
But
which technically makes it kind of art.
But it's the kind of statement that a 30-year-old kid who likes throwing people get their heads chopped off could make if it is what it looks like. It's the kind of like, yeah, so you can make a really, really horrendously violent game. And it could be a case of maybe the audience will be the deciding factor on that. If it's popular, then... Or if it's not popular, people will vote with their wallets, then we'll know one way or the other, I guess.
Well, Mythalos just said it's not very good from the reviews he's read. I haven't read any reviews either. I've not really paid that much attention to it, but I think what...
It's a hatred he's talking about.
I think so, yes, I believe so. Yeah. I'm not too worried, I have to be honest. If it's just North American adult-only rated games, and they're responding to Hatred being brought out, and the only other... I mean, you can stream GTA... San Andreas. You just can't stream the Hot Coffee mod, I believe. That's the only thing that was... I think it was made an AO, and then it got reduced back down to a mature at some point because they removed the Hot Coffee mod. I don't even know what... I can't even remember what the Hot Coffee mod did, how drastic it was.
You could just bring back girlfriends, couldn't you? I don't think it was actually like prostitutes. It was... people you have relationships with.
When you get the girlfriend, you have to get them up to the point, then they can invite you in for coffee. That was the key, wasn't it, in the game?
Yeah.
And then you basically would cut to CJ leaving the house afterwards. But in the game, you get to see what happens. But I still think it's quite primitive and inoffensive because it's the Grand Theft Auto San Andreas engine. I mean, how explicit do they expect it to be?
Hot Coffee mod, was that just basically you could see the actual act taking place?
As I understand it. I've not really looked into it because I was never that interested anyway, but pretty sure that's what it is.
From what I can remember, it wasn't so much a mod in that it was already content in the game that people unlocked, so the mod was actually just to reveal this content that was already there as well. So it was a planned feature that they basically dropped at the last minute but left all the models and the animations and stuff in there.
Yeah, yeah. And the scenes.
I can't say I was bothered by it not being an original game.
No, but I mean, literally, the list of AO-rated video games. Let me just read out some of the other ones. One sec. All Nude Cyber, 1997 on the Mac, Windows. All Nude Glamour. All Nude Nikki. Obviously, all porn games. GTA San Andreas. Hatred.
There is a grey area, and that's... What about mods for games? Like, all of the myriad of mods for Skyrim, which... basically make people naked
not,
and...
They're not ESRB rated. They will still come under the sexual content, I imagine. Because there's still...
So will they be banned?
Probably. I mean, if someone gets wind of it, you'll get a warning or you'll get banned on your channel. Okay. For doing it. It's up to you if you want to stream it, though, and get banned for it. I mean, you won't see me getting my tits out, you know, on this channel. While playing intentionally playing a game with nudity or sex in it, you know?
What's the pity, eh?
You know what, right? Have you played the Kira storyline through, Sam, in The Witcher?
That's the witch that you meet.
Yeah.
Kira Metz, is that her name?
Yeah.
The blonde. Yeah, I have, yeah.
All right, again, the ending of that, there's a few...
I don't know, because that's an open-ended one as well. I can tell you what I did if you want.
Mine isn't open-ended, put it that way, the way that I ended it.
The way I ended it is... It was conclusive, but I've got a feeling that I could have got another way with it. But I chose to be honourable and fair. I'm trying to be a good Witcher guy.
I'm trying to be a good honourable warrior. I did something that was potentially not honourable. Anyway, basically, at one point in that quest, there is an option to have sex with her or to get it on with her. I said no. I never usually say no in these games to that kind of thing, but I was like, no, it doesn't feel right with her. It feels like she's trying to get some. It feels like she's trying to get one over on me. I was right, by the way. But it doesn't matter, because you know what she does instead of if you just go and sit under the stars and she whispers something in your ear and she casts a spell on you. So
That's what happens if you sleep with her. Afterwards, you lie there naked, then she does the same thing, whispers a spell, and you fall asleep.
I could feel that. I could tell that was the case, because it sounds like that is what. Yeah. Anyway, whatever. Right. Let's stop talking about The Witcher.
Yep.
Spoilers.
Nvidia released the 980 Ti.
Yes, new flagship card. Fucking weeks after I get my 980. Fucking weeks. Well pissed off about that. I am well pissed off because I would have got this, and this supports 4K resolutions better. This is going forward going to support VR better. This is all the other shit that comes with it, and I'm well miffed about this. Because I can't run The Witcher at 60 FPS. 580-odd quid.
Jesus. Right. Okay, I suppose that's to be something between the normal cards and the Titan cards, isn't there?
One thing that interested me about reading or listening, there's a YouTube video I just posted there as well, and it's just some guy on YouTube doing a review, but he said that Nvidia have now starting to focus on VR stuff, and I think it was something like by June next year or in a year's time, they're expecting to have 5 million people using virtual reality.
Ambitious?
Yeah.
It is an ambitious thing, but there's a lot of people creating VR headsets, isn't there?
But thinking about it, 5 million is not that much when you think about the human race in general.
It's not, but it's a lot for gaming terms. Like, if you think a game sells 5 million copies, that's a lot of copies it's sold.
It is. It's a hell of a successful game if it sells 5 million. Worldwide, even.
I'm not sure, you know. I think they're a lot higher these days.
The big boys are, like your Grand Theft Auto 5s are, yeah, but let's say, I don't know, try to think of a decent franchise. Let's say a new Ratchet & Clank game comes out. It's going to do good numbers, but it isn't going to be like millions upon millions worldwide. It's going to do good numbers, but not crazy.
So the biggest selling game ever, according to Wikipedia, was 100 million, and that was Tetris.
That's pretty funny.
But yeah, the in the list,
11.2,
Diablo 3 sold 15 million.
Grand Theft Auto, 11.2 million copies, made $800 million.
There you go. So 11 million, that's one of the most successful games ever. 5 million is an incredibly high number.
It is.
Yeah, you're right there. Maybe they're talking about other uses of VR as well, maybe. You know, I'm talking about selling it to education, selling it to...
I imagine they will, into businesses and things like that.
The armed forces, things like that, you know.
Yeah.
But still, I still think that's ambitious. I mean, Nvidia know better than us. They've got a much bigger R&D department than we do. But you know, it's like
big for yourself.
But I still
don't get everything right, though. They don't get everything right. I mean, you know, they're still trying to peddle that bloody Shield shite.
No, but everyone does that.
Gaming tablets.
XCOM 2 has been announced. I am quite excited about this.
Yeah, so am I. Especially as it looks like it's a reboot of XCOM Apocalypse.
Well, it's a carry on from the premise of the game. So the sounds of it is that the aliens are now running the Earth, and XCOM are actually an underground faction. And the fact that it's going to be another XCOM game, and it leads on from Enemy Unknown and Enemy Within, which I thoroughly loved and enjoyed, I'm looking forward to it. Just can't wait. The little teaser trailer that we've got with it's quite cool as well. And the graphics don't look great, though, do they?
No. But then again, there's another game that we'll talk about a little bit later, which I think the graphics will look great on.
Right.
There's been a few announcements recently where the graphics have not been the focus of the game. Or they certainly haven't been the selling point. Not compared to things like the new Batman game, which is all about that graphics.
that graphics.
I'm not sure if all is the right phrase to
use.
Well,
maybe
there.
Not all, but it's still very... There haven't been many games pushing the envelope of what graphics technology could do.
I agree. I mean, The Witcher has. It looks very, very good. Looks very, very good. But, yeah, and then this new... But just remember that all the other Batman games, apart from the one that wasn't done by Rocksteady, which was Arkham City...
Origins.
Have been very good gameplay as well. And they've looked quite good for the time, and they've got brilliant combat systems and everything else. Everything's wonderful about those games.
I would say that the Arkham games went for an aesthetic style over high-tech graphics, as it were. Like there's an art style to the games that suited them, but they weren't the best graphics games of that generation, not by a long shot, but they had an art style that suited them.
They were
more about the gameplay, really. That's what the game's strength is.
You know what? I would rather The Witcher again ran at 60 FPS and didn't lag ever, and I could play it consistently at 60 FPS, than it look beautiful. I really would. I don't really care about the looks of games that much. I know I've just criticised XCOM for not looking great, but for a game that's coming up, you expect the animation and the facial stuff to look a bit better these days, don't you?
Well, the next piece of news is that the new Witcher patch is targeting the frame rates.
Yes.
And bad candles, which is true. The candles are annoying as shit. So, yeah. Lou, basically, you have... when you walk near a candle, because you've got this fire thing, you can ignite or extinguish the candles. But, I mean, this is on the PlayStation, that is the X button, which is the same as your loot and interact button. So you go to a chest that's next to a candle, and it's sort of context sensitive. So if you're near the candle, you try to open the chest and you keep going like that and lighting the candle. It's just like, for fuck's sake, I really don't want to light the candle, do I?
You have to move your character just slightly to the side just so you can open the loot the chest. Sometimes you can't loot the chest at all because it's just so fucking annoying to get it. So I think what they're going to do is just going to go, if candle near chest, then don't light candle. That's all the code's going
to
be, basically.
What if you want to light the candle? Or what if you're trying to access a candle near some source of loot?
Maybe what they'll do is they'll run a...
They'll introduce another button, that's what they'll do. They'll make it bind bloody F3 to extinguish candle.
You can buy an extra keyboard with another button that you stick on the end of your keyboard and then use that button.
Little known fact is that you could light the candle anyway just by pressing 5, which is Igni, and then casting Igni on the candle. Fair enough, everything else around will catch fire as well, but you'll be able to light the fucking candle. I love doing that. I went into a shrine the other day with candles everywhere and just cast Igni on them all, and they all went poof. Brilliant. Loved it. Right, next Witcher 3. Yes, we talked about that.
Patch and stuff.
Yep.
So, yeah, I'm looking forward to that because, I mean, the frame rate's not terrible, don't get me wrong, but it could be better, you know, especially when it gets a bit crazy.
E3, frame rate's okay on the PS4, but I'm guessing it could be better.
E3's coming up. June 16th, June 18th in LA. Again, does not relate to us in the UK, really. I still want to go to one day. I want to go to an E3. Although I'll probably get bored.
Go to one.
Or PAX. You would not get bored there.
Not E3.
The problem with going to E3 for me would be that my wife would be extremely jealous that I'm going to America. And she'd want to go to America as well.
Well, E3 is only on for what? Is it a week, is it?
It's a weekend.
Oh, is it? It's a weekend. Well, why don't you go for like a couple of weeks and have E3 in the middle of it or something, or at the start or the end? Or...
Oh, could do, I suppose.
You're going to turn it into a holiday.
Well, yeah, I want to go back anyway at some point soon, so yeah, good idea. Maybe.
But I think we'll be covering a lot of the E3 stuff in the next couple of episodes as well.
Yeah, inadvertently, especially, at least, anyway.
Yeah, in a couple of weeks' time, because it'll be the day before E3 kicks off, so...
They're going to drop, obviously, a shitload of new announcements and trailers for things that we already know, but we're going to get new info. Like, I'm hoping that they're going to give some sort of gameplay footage of the new Deus Ex game and not just that CGI trailer that we've got so far.
This is the time when all the developers are working ridiculous hours and all the little guys are just stressed out of their faces because they're crunching for these final videos that need to go out. And they're right, you need to get that. You need to get that person picking that up in the right way so we can show it in the video. Oh, I don't think I can do it for Monday. Sorry, Jeff.
Do it now!
Yeah,
the worst
yeah.
will be the people who are working for Ubisoft.
Also going to be reducing your pay at the same time and then firing you afterwards.
The people at Ubisoft will basically... It'll be slave labour. They'll basically be on a galley being whipped.
That was, We've got six Assassin's Creed titles to announce at this one E3. Get them ready to show the same gameplay we've already done for the last 10 years.
I'm looking forward to some gameplay footage for Doom. The Doom reboot.
Yeah. I never
Because all I've seen so far is 10 seconds and 5 seconds of that was logo. And it was a Revenant and a shotgun.
I'm not usually a fan of watching videos and trailers and that, but I don't know. I'm getting a bit more into it as I'm not playing as many games now. I kind of want something to draw me in, you know? I don't have the time to play a game, all the games I want. So I need to be more picky about them. So maybe trailers are the right way to go for me. I don't know. But usually they're full of shit, aren't they? They're full of stuff that's not actually in the game.
Yeah, the
Ubisoft
trailers,
yeah.
A lot of the time they're just blatant lies. But I'll still be checking out the highlights of E3 at the very least, just the stuff that I'm interested in, like everybody else will.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah, so that's coming up, and good luck to him.
We will cover that a lot more in the next couple of weeks.
Yeah.
Especially as within a fortnight, we'll be in the middle of E3.
Now, talking about Arkham Knight having all these latest graphics and, you know, pushing the envelope and having 8K textures and everything else that it's going to have, it's also not going to have any loading screens, they say. Anywhere, they said. Now, I don't see how this is going to... I know they can hide things with mini-games and they can hide things with, you know, while you're doing something and they can stream areas of the world, but what about the initial load into the game? How are they...
Well, it's going to have a load into the game. They can't not have that, yeah.
But
they'll probably do it like GTA 5. Well, it'll be like GTA 5. It'll be streaming the game as you're playing it, but it actually might be a bad thing because if it means that you can't... If it's no loading screens, it means there'll be no big jumps from one area to another. It'll be all quite linear, if you think about it.
Well, that's the point of these games, isn't it? I mean, look at GTA 5. That isn't linear.
Yeah, but when it still has loading screens, which it tries to hide as you kind of zooming out of the map and then zooming back in.
Only
on the map.
In the single player, and only when it does in the multiplayer, but it's
there's
more
lots
obvious.
Of multiplayer.
Yeah, it's more obvious in the multiplayer. But yeah, streaming. But maybe we don't have any of that though, do we? We don't have any of that jumping in and out of areas. I don't
but
want
you can
to jump
fast,
from.
You can fast travel in Arkham. I think you can fast travel in Arkham Origins. So, because the city was bigger, they might were probably going to implement some sort of fast travel, and fast travel lends itself to loading one section of the city as you go there.
Yeah.
Unless they hide it by the fact that you're in the Batmobile and you see the Batmobile driving to the location, and that's like the loading screen hidden by that. But it's they're going to hide them. That's what they mean. They're going to be there and just going to hide them.
I think it's clickbait. That, to be honest.
Yeah.
I think it's a little bit. I'm not that bothered either if it's a few seconds of loading screen.
Well, neither am I. I am bothered about bloody GTA loading screens. My God, the amount you have to wait for that. Even on an awesome PC. What?
I've heard even with SSDs, it's really slow.
Incidentally, what's the Witcher 3 loading times like? Because when I die on that, the load times are quite long.
No, it's instant. It's almost instant on my PC. And I am not even on an SSD. I mean, when I first load the game up, the loading screen is mostly hidden by that annoying screen that I said last week, you know, where it says the Witcher wanted to do this, and then he saw Kira, and then he went to the town, and then he had a bath, you know, that kind of shit. You know, it has a little summary of what's coming up, and you can't skip it. That's the loading screen. But once that's done, you get a tiny little bar, and it's usually loaded in a few seconds. If I die and then reload... Almost instant. Remember that, it doesn't matter how much people go on about the PS4. So when I read that PlayStation magazine, the amount that they spunk over the specs of the PS4, it's like...
Well,
mate,
of course they're going to do that.
I know they're paid to do it, but it's not meaty. It's not awesome. It's a piece of shit. It's not a piece of shit, but you know what I mean? It's like, it's not as amazing as they go on about it. Oh, these specs are brilliant. Fuck off. Anyway, Arkham Knight's out on the 23rd of June. We've now got a date for it as well, so I'm looking forward to that. I've got it all ready. Steam. Sat there ready to go.
I'm probably going to get that straight away as well, but I'm quite confident in those guys making a cool third installment for that game.
Yeah, I think they'll only get better with it as well, this one. They've proved themselves twice to me, I think. The first
one's
still the best.
they're talking about it. This has been the end of it as well. They want to sort of go. The third game is the end of the sort of story, as it were. So I'm happy with that. That they can do like, it's a good series. Batman is a kind of character you can keep reinventing him for computer games anyway. So you can go like the Batman Arkham series ends with this one, and then just put a lid on it and gone. I'm sure they'll release other expansions with other studios, but I'm quite happy for them to do a finite series in a game and just be like, yeah, the game series is done now. We're going to move on and do something else.
As we've said multiple times, I'd rather they finished, you know, Ubisoft didn't keep doing the same bloody game all the time type thing. I'd rather studios kept doing new franchises and new IPs and, you know, putting effort into them instead of bleeding us dry, I think.
Do a trilogy, that's three games, and then stop and do something else.
Didn't the producer of Assassin's Creed say, oh, we've always had it planned that we'd do 48 games, something like that?
Yeah, but George Lucas said he'd make 9 movies.
Yeah. Well, look, you were lucky to get the first one made and you know it, so shut up. To all of those people that say that, bollocks, it's like, you had one, and then you were lucky to get the other ones made, and then you pretended that you've always had a plan. You might have had this like vague plan of like, oh, what if like, da-da-da-da, but you didn't have it written down. You didn't have these books written out of like plot for the next 17 installments in your franchise. You had one. When that got made, you were fucking happy that it got made, and then you made more. That's pretty much what happened. And the Matrix,
couldn't even be bothered directing them.
When they say that The Matrix was a planned trilogy, of course it fucking wasn't. It blatantly wasn't. It blatantly wasn't.
Awful. They were awful films.
I'm glad you recognise that, Chris.
That the end, there was 10 seconds before the end of the last, the first Matrix, they could have stopped. They could have stopped that trilogy. After that, the last 10 seconds of the first and the rest of the trilogy, no. Yeah. And the Animatrix as well, that can fuck off.
I quite like the Animatrix.
Yeah, but you're a bender.
Good. That's just side stories, though, so it's alright.
Anyway.
Right. Yeah.
Bard's Tale 4.
Have you played any of the Bard's Tales?
I've played a little bit of some of them. It's not my kind of thing because it's kind of party-based. Well, it might be awful, but this is a couple of days into its Kickstarter. It's already got $871,000.
That just means a lot of supporters are awful, too.
Okay. Well, someone might be interested in that anyway.
Michael Bay's films make a lot of money in the box. I mean, it doesn't make them good. I don't know.
It's by the same people who did Wasteland 2, which was very popular.
I've never played The Bard's Tale, so I'm just being devil's advocate here. They could be good for all I know. I know nothing about them.
I have the original. Never played it.
What kind of game is it even?
It's an RPG, but it's one where you control a party rather than an individual.
Okay.
And it's got a lot of humour in it. It's very tongue in cheek.
Is it good humour? Is it like it thinks it's funny, but it isn't?
In a legend of the Orkney Islands, take the role of the bard, a sardonic and opportunistic. Oh my god, musician and adventurer, driven by carnal rather than noble pursuits. Forget your quest to save the world. You are interested in just two things: coin and cleavage.
Okay.
Done. That's why anyway, I haven't installed it ever.
It's doing well on Kickstarter anyway, so someone loves it, if not you two.
Cleavage.
It could be good for a lot. I just wanted to jump on and hating it for the last.
Shall we address the big news of the day?
Yes, that we've left right until the end.
We have, because we're teasing bastards.
Just like this game trailer was a teasing bastard as well.
Well, no, the loading screen on the website has been a teasing bastard all week.
It has. Yeah,
very good.
So, Fallout 4 trailer came out today. What do we think?
Right, Chris, the first thing I can't wait, but one thing that struck me was that, again, they were really leaning heavily on the dog thing again, and I'm worried that, again, it's going to be a massive fucking letdown. I want a game where you have a dog companion that actually is your companion, that the dog might be able to be like an early warning system, might smell mutants, and you'd be like, what's going on? And you know the dog comes alert, but the dog doesn't run off and get killed by ants every 3 seconds.
Maybe you are a dog in this. Didn't think of that, did you?
Oh!
No.
Maybe you're actually dog poo.
It's just dog poo?
Just dog poo, and that's it. That's the entire game. Maybe you're a fly around dog poo.
Can I, as a little aside,
it's a huge aside, 26 square mile map, and you've only got this one little bit of it.
There's just like the flies in New Vegas, isn't there? There's mutant flies in that. What do you think of the graphics? Because I was quite disappointed with it. It looks worse than Skyrim, and Skyrim is a 4-year-old game. I presume it uses the same engine.
There's some elements that look better, but a lot of it, like the animations and the characters, don't look very. I mean, the environments look pretty, very pretty from what I can see.
I think the animation's good.
I think the world looks more interesting. It's got a better color palette. It looks more saturated. It's not yellow like all of Fallout was. But the graphics are not certainly not current gen.
The dog looked like it shit itself. I didn't think it was that good. It was walking like a chicken.
What I meant was, it did little head movements and stuff that looked quite realistic to what dogs do. It didn't look. It could be better, but it didn't. It looked quite good. I thought it looked a shitload better than most dogs that I've seen in video games.
What says it needed hair flow? As in, yeah, no, I'm kind of in agreement. It should. By now, we should be starting to look at decent looking hair on PC, shouldn't we? On games, rather.
I just posted a link into the chat, but there's an article that was written today by Jimquisition. Let's look at the smooth Fallout 4 ass, which was just a criticism of the quality of the guy's ass at the end of the trailer.
Okay.
Because it sums it up though. It looks low res. It looks low poly. It looks like a game from 5-6 years ago. Well, I was loving this article already.
I'm interested because
it's got Metal Gear Solid on it.
One of the things that I really noticed was when Fallout 3 came out, I looked at it and went, this is the exact same aesthetic engine as Oblivion, which was also several years old at that point. And I'm wondering if Fallout 4 is just going to be the same engine they used for Skyrim, but with
it
Fallout.
Is.
It's, so it's going to look like that. It's going to look like Skyrim, but Fallout, what it's going to be. That's what they did for
Skyrim
Fallout 3.
I don't mind.
Yes. I don't know. It's not, for one, it's not ready yet, so it could improve before
I thought Fallout 3 looked a lot better than Oblivion. And it was the same engine, so I would like to think that Fallout 4 would look a lot better than Skyrim. It's a 4-year-old game, remember? It came out in 2011. Skyrim.
Yeah.
We have made some progress. So I don't know what's going on. Whether it's just a game that's taken a long time to develop. Whether they're putting all the effort into the world, which the world does look very interesting. There's a lot more urban areas. A lot more recognizable areas.
I hope there's some vehicles in this one. Sorry.
Well, maybe it depends on. There was a reason for it last time, wasn't there? That there was a nuclear war, and the same has happened here. So,
yeah, but certain that there were vehicles in the game, you just couldn't drive any of them. There were other people used them, and you couldn't.
Weren't they all burnt out?
No, there was the whatchamacallem, the what's the bad guys called? The government guys. They appeared in dropships and stuff.
True.
Periodically throughout the game, as you got to the later levels, they would just turn up in dropships. So it was technology out there, just you couldn't ever use a vehicle.
I think it was a limitation of the engine itself, though.
I understand that.
I think you can't move too fast across the landscape because of the way it streams the landscape in.
I think the fact that they've clearly set this one up to be there's more rebuilt areas with electricity and power and stuff like that, it's going to feel more incongruous if there isn't any vehicles. You're in a sci-fi dystopian future where you have to go everywhere on foot, but there's like high-tech cities in there. That's going to not feel right if they don't give you some kind of vehicle or something to get around the world a bit. But even if it's just a crappy little, you know, scooter that's a hover scooter or something, it'd be better than nothing, wouldn't it?
Hoverboards don't work on water.
But yeah. I am kind of looking forward to that. I like the fact that the areas in it look distinctive.
Yes.
I thought Fallout 3 was a beautiful looking game, but the areas were a bit of the Oblivion syndrome of like Lego areas that have been put together from a few modules. Whereas this looks very like they put a lot more time into the world. So maybe that's what they've spent the last 4 years doing.
I'm still up for it. I think we've been quite negative so far, but I still. I'm up for Fallout 4.
Me
very,
too.
Very much so.
I haven't played New Vegas. I started playing it and I did about 19 minutes and then something distracted me and I haven't went back to it. And I really
I've
should.
Played a couple of hours of it and I'm just... I prefer Fallout 3, to be honest.
I see a lot of people say that it's better than Fallout 3.
I'm not in agreement. I think the world's more bland.
Apparently, apparently the weapons in it are a bit better as a sort of shooter, which, you know, they've made it into a shooter. It's a bit better in that regard, apparently, with New Vegas. You can aim down your iron sights and do sort of more shootery things that you would expect from a shooter.
Do you still take one weapon and jam it into another until it's fixed?
Yeah, I will push these two AK-47s together and that will make one slightly better AK-47.
Just basically hell. On that note, I think I don't really care what it looks like. I mean, that's quite funny, Jim Inquisition having a go at his ass. I didn't clock that, but there's just something very flat about that world, you know, that doesn't feel like there's much tessellation or much good use of bump mapping and stuff going on. In fact, by now we should be on PBR for everything, so get on it, you bastards. Have you got anything else to say, anybody?
No.
Good.
Not to you.
Thank you very much, everybody, for watching. This has been us for the week, signing off, and hopefully we'll be back next week and we'll be talking about The Witcher more.
And hot-ass E3 shit.
On hot-ass E3 shit, possibly.
That's right.
If there's some released.
Yeah. And not flat-ass Fallout 4 shit.
No, flat. Yeah. A flat dog-ass.
Goodbye, everybody.